This week on the Pressure Cast, Psychonauts 2 turns to crowdfunding, PlayStation 2 emulation arrives on PlayStation 4, and Konami bars Kojima from the Game Awards. Plus, impressions of Xenoblade Chronicles X, Just Cause 3, Rainbow Six Siege, and Uncharted 4 multiplayer. It's Monday, December 7th, 2015. Everything happening in the world of video games will live in infamy here, now, on the Pressure Cast. Hey, Pressure Pals, welcome to the 107th episode of the Pressure Cast, VideoGamesAreDumb.com's weekly news panic that posts every single Monday on iTunes, Stitcher, YouTube, TuneIn Radio, and America's longest-running independent newspaper at ShepherdExpress.com. My name is Colin Two Coffees Tanner, and across from me, the most handsome man in video games, Steve Cuff.
Hey, Colin.
Hey, how you doing, Steve? Long time no talk.
I know.
Fantastic.
And triple threat.
And in between us, the triple threat himself, Justin Hambone Engelbart.
I like to use triple threat moves when I'm playing basketball because you don't know what to expect.
That's absolutely accurate. We have so much news to get to. We have to talk about the VGAs. We have to talk about the PlayStation experience. We have to talk about the recent comments from Nintendo's president about the NX. So much to get to, but of course, we better tell you what the show's all about. Each week, the Pressure Cast slices up the latest video game news, past, present, and future. And places it into several sensational segments, delivering it right into your ears in 2 hours and hopefully less, because we have so much to get to. Starting it off with the very first segment, thank you for the email. That's right. Each week we respond back to those viewers who write into us at pressurecast@gmail.com or even call us at 954-947-7377. Text message, voice message. It's all good. Or you can even tweet at us.
You can send us a hologram if you want.
That would be very impressive. At PressurecastPod. Do you think Tupac is going to come out? Just be like,
hey, Pressure Pals.
I was wondering about the 3DS. So we have our first email from Big Matty West. Top-notch show as always, guys. Keep up the great work. I have a question for you, if I may. With all the, of course you can.
Wait,
Big
should we
Matty
let him?
West.
Should we let him?
We have.
You may. You may, Matty.
Thank you. With all the Game Awards coming up, I want to know what game you had the most fun with in 2015. I don't mean which one of you should win Game of the Year. Which one you think should win Game of the Year, but just what you enjoyed playing the most. Thanks, guys. I look forward to the next show. Big Matty West. We even got a message about the exact same thing from Keon. Let's hear it from Keon in Baltimore.
Hey, what's going on, Pressure Cast crew? How are you guys doing? Oh, man, it's been a while since I've called in. This is Keon from Baltimore. I just wanted to let you guys know that I'm continuously following the show. I love the show, you guys. Always keep me in stitches and do such an excellent job at those doggone commercials. Let me tell you, they are always very, very entertaining and hilarious, to say the least. But I was calling in to really get you guys' opinion. You know, it's the end of the year. All of the major games have come out. So with that being said, I'm sure you guys are going to have a show about it. But I wanted to ask you guys, what would be your Game of the Year contenders at this point? Not trying to spoil the show for later, but just was curious if you guys wouldn't mind answering that. Once again, thank you guys so much for the hard work that you guys put in every week. I'm a faithful listener, and just great job, guys. Keep up the good work, and y'all take care. Bye-bye.
Keon, thank you for the voicemail. Big Matty West, thank you for the email. Guys, seriously, Keon, I appreciate you. You are a bundle of freaking sunshine. Yeah. Every time this guy calls in, I'm just like, oh, I feel so happy. It's so happy. So wonderful. Same with Big Matty West, always bringing the hard question to us.
I just picture these guys driving their trucks cross country.
We don't know what Big Matty West drives.
He's got a truck, dude.
He's got a truck.
He's got a smart car.
There you go. It drives itself. That way you can play your Vita on the go. Guys, here's the thing. We can't answer that. I hate to say it. That was a lot of buildup for absolutely nothing. But I do want to impress upon all of you that the very last Monday of December, we will have the best games of 2015. And I encourage you, don't send it in right away. Let it marinate in your brain for a bit. Right before the last Monday, the last Sunday, because that's when we record these, send in your email. Let us know what your favorite games of the year were. We want to hear from you. You can call us, tweet us, or just email us. All that information is in the description below of the YouTube page and this podcast.
Can I get hot fudge on my Sunday?
Okay. Guys.
Damn it, Justin. I'm going to kill you.
I hate myself.
Oh, no. Here it comes. Kabloom. That's right. It's time for the earth-shattering news. News. We have the most jam-packed earth-shattering news because we are literally going to cover the PlayStation Experience and the VGAs. I'm sorry, the Game Awards.
Okay,
in their entireties with this question. Who had the bigger announcements? What was the more entertaining show right here, PlayStation Experience versus the VGAs? We're going to kick it off. I keep saying VGAs. They're not that anymore. They're the Game Awards.
How dare you? What would Jeff Keighley say?
No one heard what you said, Steve. You got to yell on the mic. Yell on the mic.
What would Jeff Keighley say?
There we go.
What would Jeff Keighley say?
There we go.
Who's Jeff Keighley?
He'd say, buy Doritos and Mountain Dew for your Halo points.
He would. I will defend that man to the death. I'm a big fan of Jeff Keighley. What can I say? He has his online-only show that streams. It's the Game Awards. He used to be on Spike TV. That was abysmal. I think we can all agree for years that show just never brought together. Then he did the VGX. And now he's back with the Game Awards. Last year, pretty good show. This year, well, let's find out. So here's what happened. They kicked off the show. Jeff Keighley was there. And I wrote down this quote from the intro. It's about the worlds in which we game and the players who game within them.
Ew.
I know.
That's me and you, right, Steve?
Yeah. Yeah, that's you guys, not me. They actually had best multiplayer. That's what kicked off the show. Splatoon won for best multiplayer as well as best shooter. Hmm. Pretty exciting. Yeah.
Well deserved.
Yeah, Splatoon, very, very good. Best mobile game was Lara Croft Go. They showed off some Uncharted 4 gameplay. Not much to go on. It was just random clips all together. They did show off a new character. It was a woman. It was a woman, a black woman. And they also showed Drake's wedding ring. He was holding the door. He actually has his wedding ring on, so we know he's actually still married, or he is married finally.
Hotline Bling, huh?
And she kicked the shit out of him. He was like, I don't want to fight you, lady. And she's like, what's holding you back? And he's like, all right, fine. So then they cut to some giant montage. They actually had a lot of the nominees on sale for the Game Awards. They kept pumping that, saying, hey, you know, go over to PSN or Xbox Live or Steam, and you can buy that for
50% off.
Exactly. Ubisoft actually brought a robotic woolly mammoth, like this animatronic woolly mammoth that was outside the Game Awards, and they put like a balloon below it, and it was stomping on balloons.
Oh, for Far Cry. Primal?
For Far Cry. Yeah.
You know what? That
Steve,
sounds great.
I'm not hearing you, buddy. I can't.
I don't. I'm. I swear to God, I'm talking
right
into the damn thing.
You're looking at me. You gotta look at me.
I don't want to look at these people.
There you go. Look at the
nice
people.
I want to lock eyes with Big Maddie. Right
so we
now.
Had our very first big announcement as Shaquille O'Neal took the stage, telling everybody, if you look under your seats, everybody gets a free copy of the 1994 original Shaq Fu. And he's like, just kidding, man.
Anybody want a copy of Shaq Fu, it's on his seat.
Okay, great. They showed off the footage of Shaq Fu, the very first time we've actually seen in-game footage.
Dude, that game looks great.
That game looks absolutely atrocious.
No, it looks so good.
I couldn't tell what was going on. They were so tiny.
It looks like,
Double Dragon Neon. Like, it doesn't... It's not a fighting game, right? It's like a side-scrolling beat-em-up?
It's a beat-em-up, and it's very, very small characters...
But Shaq, he's a big character.
Yeah, well, apparently he gets raised in China. He was in a purse or something when he was a baby.
It's kind of like a Moses story.
Yeah, exactly. And
Shaq Moses.
No, I'm the best fighter in the world.
But they also had a little bit of influence from Turtles in Time because they actually threw the characters directly into the screen. Like, they broke the screen.
I want that Turtles thing you could do.
Well, that was all they had from there. They announced a brand new esports league called E-League coming to TBS, which is pretty significant. TBS, which shows plenty of sports, now going to just start airing E-League stuff.
Yeah, they show Atlanta sports because it's an Atlanta-based, Georgia-based company.
It is worth noting that they only advertised CSGO for that E-League. They showed off a brand new world premiere. They had basically a bunch of ink. It was like everything was turning into a newspaper, just a white page. All this ink is talking about guns, and there's crime, and there's everything, and then it says Telltale Games, and it says Batman. Telltale Games, Batman. Is that a good mix right there?
Maybe.
I'm just sick of these Telltale Games games. Aren't they all kind of...
I mean, I love Telltale Games, and they are... Obviously, the tone is different between the different ones. I think a Batman one can work if it really emphasizes like the detective comics sort of side of things.
Yeah.
The only thing I'm concerned about is you can't have Batman without some sort of combat, just like you can't have The Walking Dead without combat.
I disagree, because in the comic books, there's tons of issues where he's not even fighting anybody.
I was going to stay
Yeah,
the
well,
house.
I mean, you're right. There are tons of issues where they're not fighting anyone.
He's a detective,
you know? But the question is that what Telltale's going to do? So if you ask anybody, okay, so The Walking Dead series from Telltale is great, but what's the worst part? The combat. It's always horrendous.
I hope that they actually pick like an interesting comic. I hope it's not an original story, even though it probably will be. Like, I'd love to see them like tackle The Dark Knight Returns or something like that, where they could actually capture some of the like the spirit of Batman. I wonder if there's going to be a narrator. I wonder like how they're going to approach
call
this.
It the spirit
but,
of Batman.
But even like
they need a good writer. They need like a Paul Dini. They need an actual
Grant
Batman.
Morrison
or Grant Morrison. They need a real Batman writer. Yeah, they need a real Batman writer.
The problem is though is like even if you talk about The Dark Knight Returns, like there's so many big action set pieces within The Dark Knight Returns. So I don't know what kind of story you're going to like if you're pulling from existing lore and existing narratives, well, like what you're going to pull out of that.
Maybe you select a punch, or you select maybe throwing gas, or you select just like negotiate. You know, there's I see a lot of avenues just because, you know, Batman is a very diverse character, and I wonder if this is going to be gritty Batman, or is this going to be 60s Batman? Like, they could do a 1960s Batman like nothing else. They could do that if they really wanted
to. Adam West Batman?
Yeah, why not?
Yeah, that'd be great. Here's a guy who wouldn't shave his mustache off.
Yeah. Well, and honestly, the Joker.
If it was 1960s Batman, I almost feel like the inevitable quick time fighting events would be way better, because it'd be like, you know, oh, you got to hit circle at the right time, and it's just like, bam, and it plays that like,
it'd be awesome.
Over back at the Game Awards, they cut to the green room where Deadmau5 was hanging out, and he said he enjoyed Star Wars Battlefront. It was the green room was sponsored by AMD, and they basically just asked Celebrity, what do you think about this Star Wars Battlefront? You except for the brand new Star Wars
Deadmau5
movie?
Deadmau5 is like, I'm so high right now, I don't care.
They also announced that they were going to have 3 short films about developers playing throughout the Game Awards. The first one actually showed a group of Americans in Tokyo making a game that looked a lot like Journey. It was a team of 7. And that's all we really know. It was like a thunderstorm in a desert. It looked a lot like Journey. Just picture Journey. That's what the game looked like. Very, very short films. Didn't get a whole lot of detail on these guys, but it was sponsored by Unity, and it was saying, like, these games are only possible. This era of independent development is only available through Unity. So a little bit of the sponsorship creeping in there. They actually showed some new Elder Scrolls Online expansion pack. It was something we already knew about. It was just a brand new trailer. Troy Baker took the stage for best performance. It was very amusing because he said, if you want to become a voice actor in video games, just buy a decent microphone and then just, you know, wait for me and Nolan North to die. So it was pretty funny. It was pretty good.
Does he mean a better microphone than the ones we have?
Yeah. Oh, he took the stage for best narrative. The best narrative of the year was won by Her Story, and the woman who plays the main character actually got up on stage and, you know, she talked a little bit.
You know why Her Story won? Because, like, 3 months ago, I was pimping it on the Pressure Cast.
See,
so
that's
all me. It's all me. You're welcome. You're welcome.
We actually got to see some new footage of Ubisoft's Montreal's Far Cry Primal. It looks a lot better. You actually train animals. There's wolves. There's bears.
Dragons.
Saber-toothed tigers, and the idea of having a big kitty with me out in the jungle to fight people, that's pretty great.
Can you get a dragon?
I don't...
Or is that Blood Dragon?
It's supposed to be the actual Stone Age, man. What are you talking about?
Maybe let's put a dragon in there. Who cares?
Okay, great.
Just really want dragons.
And a werewolf, too, probably, right?
We actually saw a musical performance from Churches. That was kind of interesting.
Oh, I like Churches. They're good.
The girl can really sing, man. She was great. They had a commercial for Lego Avengers. We finally know a little bit more. Lego Avengers, and I don't know if we were aware about this before, but it's actually based on the Marvel Cinematic Universe, not just the comic book universe, and actually covers, I believe, both of the Captain America movies, Thor of the Dark World, both Avenger films, and Iron Man 3, I believe, are covered in there.
Oh, that's ambitious.
I know. I actually thought, like, that sounds interesting. The only problem is that it's Lego, and Lego sucks. So that's, you know.
Yeah. I wonder if you're going to punch stuff, and it's going to turn into little Lego bits that you collect.
Oh, my God. What a dream.
Do you think they could ever do that in a Lego game?
I'm
being cynical. No, it's going to be so fun.
No, you play so many goddamn indie games that you come up with these really ambitious ideas, like collecting stubs that you, like, and then you build a door that shakes around and drops more studs. I don't know. Sean Layden from Sony took the stage for favorite trending gamer.
Oh, was it me? Was it me? Was it me? Was it me?
No,
was it me? Was it me?
It was PewDiePie, and there was Total Biscuit, and Greg fucking Miller won, who used to be at IGN. And I don't know about you guys. I'm a big Greg Miller guy. I actually really think he's up.
You felt like you got snubbed, don't you?
No, he got up on he won the fucking award. He got up on stage and was just like, hey, let's all just take a moment. He called out Nicole Tan. He goes, who's Nicole Tan? She's some random artist from Rise of the Tomb Raider. I just spotted her name yesterday. I want to give her a shout out because we don't know enough of the people that are behind these games. Gave a shout out to everyone that works in the industry. Just like this really amazing speech. Highly recommend you watch it. I was shocked at how good it was. I don't know. I like the stuff they do. What can I say?
I was surprised that he won that because I think if
he was pimping down his podcast, though. He says, let's all beat PewDiePie.
Well, was it like fan voting? Is that how it was determined?
For that one,
for
yes.
For that one? Okay. Yeah, that was super surprising because I think
PewDiePie, do you think the fans would have voted for Her Story? Like, come on.
Yeah, no, that's...
Women, no!
there's not enough game.
Mark Hamill, for some reason, was the guy that represented the Video Game Awards.
Was he really?
Women, no! I didn't know I could do the Joker. That's cool.
That was pretty good.
I don't know. This is news to me. They had a brand new premiere. It was a bunch of military people talking about some sort of island that had, you know, water full of mines and the air was full of dirty bombs. And it was all controlled by one sleeping girl that was imagining all those drones were actually little sheep. And it was the reveal of Psychonauts 2 going to Fig for crowdfunding. Psychonauts 2. If you remember, if you have a pretty long memory, you might remember that Mojang, the guy, who's the guy behind Minecraft? What the hell's wrong with my brain? This
Johnny week? Mojang.
Notch. He actually was on Twitter saying like, "Hey, let's make Psychonauts 2. Let's make this happen." And nothing really happened from there. Everyone thought it was going to be going to Kickstarter. Double Fine, of course, they have a pretty relationship with Kickstarter. They really were the very first high profile game to go to Kickstarter, but the results, well, they didn't turn out exactly how they wanted to. Instead, they're going to Fig. Fig is like Kickstarter, except invest enough money, it's an actual investment, as in you get a return if the game sells well, yada yada yada.
What, I'm gonna use this.
I mean, Psychonauts 2, guys.
I'm gonna love this game, but I don't think it's gonna sell very well, which is probably why it's not.
Are you sure? Because the internet has hyped up the original Psychonauts so much.
Really?
It's one of those things.
Well, I love the original Psychonauts.
What did Mark Twain say? Classic is a book that everybody praises but nobody reads.
Samuel Clemens.
Yeah, that was his real name. But you know what I mean? Like, an actual sequel to Psychonauts, I think it'd do rather well, if you ask me. Steve, what are your thoughts on this announcement?
Yeah, I think it's a good time to do this because Psychonauts didn't sell well when it initially came out, but it's kind of, because of the internet and because of people just like talking about it and, oh, it's this, you know, undiscovered classic and yada, yada, yada. And now it's bigger than ever. I'm sure it's sold very well on Steam. In addition to that, you kind of have this like nostalgia cycle coming back around for it, and we have like games like Yooka-Laylee coming out where they're sort of reintroducing a new generation to 3D platformers.
If you're gonna
do this game, this is the time to do it.
That's a really good point. I didn't even think about Yooka-Laylee. That's fantastic. All right, pop quiz: Who was the original publisher of Psychonauts before they canceled the project, and who was the actual publisher? Pop quiz.
I don't know.
Take Two, THQ.
Who was the original one that canceled it?
SquareSoft.
Microsoft Game Studios. It was really an Xbox exclusive.
Oh, I remember that. I played that on Xbox, actually.
Yep, it was supposed to be an exclusive. And the actual publisher, Majesco. That's
Majesco.
Yeah.
Wow. They don't exist anymore, do they?
They still exist.
Okay, because I know like a couple years ago they cut back their staff like 90% or something.
Well,
like that.
It's not, you know, I would just say that they're not doing well business-wise.
Did they do Monster Rancher? Is that Majesco?
Speak up, yeah.
Monster Rancher?
Yeah, maybe.
Majesco, yeah.
No, that was Banpresto, I thought.
I think a lot of what Majesco's been doing recently is just like, I don't know, like video game adaptation of like game shows and shit.
Or we could take care of that Psychonauts sequel. Yeah. We could do that.
Yo, where's Glover 3, y'all?
We had Pete Hines from Bethesda speaking with Jeff Keighley saying they're giving away $1 million to someone that's playing Elder Scrolls Online all the way up until January 10th.
I guess I better play that game now.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, there you go.
Where's my $1 million? I'm not enjoying this at all.
Churches presented an award, believe it or not, and it was for Best Indie Game. The winner, Rocket League.
No surprise there.
It was going up against some pretty good competition. Ori and the Blind Forest was up on there, which I guess that wasn't really going to win or anything.
The funny thing about Ori and the Blind Forest is, wasn't it published by Microsoft?
It was published by Microsoft.
So how is that an indie game? Just because it's like digital only release? Or,
well, I mean, they're an independent studio. They're not acquired by anybody. Moon Studios is actually really fascinating because it's basically a bunch of different satellites, individuals across the internet building something. They have people in America, Israel, Japan, all over the world.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm not, and this is not me like, you know, talking shit about Ori and the Blind Forest.
I like when you're right there on the mic. That's my favorite part.
This is my favorite part.
I like that.
I don't see how it's an indie game. That'd be like calling like Child of Light an indie game. It's a smaller game that's like financially backed by a large company.
Well, you know.
I'm just a little salty because Undertale didn't win.
Sean Ashmore.
I love Undertale.
Sean Ashmore took the stage. He did not look happy to be there. And he was there to talk about Quantum Break. We saw a brand new trailer. Time was frozen. The guy said, "You want to know how he got superpowers?" And that was all we really got.
I froze time, and then I ran around.
Yeah. So in case you know, Quantum Break, it is the Xbox One exclusive that we're anticipating will be released next year. No confirmation on that. Jeff Keighley went back to mention Satoru Iwata, and they dedicated the next 10 minutes to the memory of Satoru Iwata. It was actually really
poignant,
heartbreaking, I would say. with a video tribute that basically just had all the images that we've seen of him over the past few years. Reggie took to the stage.
Big Reg.
Called him unique. Said he had the perfect. He was the perfect person to lead a video game company. Said he didn't care what he was fearless. He didn't care what anyone thought. And he goes, think about it. We call the system the Wii. It's true. He said he heard all the criticism and he went with it anyway. Gotta give him credit. Man, it was really fucking heartbreaking. Anyway, there's a couple. They went back to the short films about independent developers in Unity. They had the smuggest couple talking about their VR game, and the guy's like, you know, everyone else just wants to do the same thing. Like, why would you want to do that? Isn't that what creating is all about, is being original? And, you know, it's just, this guy looked
Look who I'm sleeping with.
He looked
That's my wife.
He looked like a Phil Fish wannabe.
Oh, great.
Like, he had the beard, the glasses, the hair. It's like, get a hold of yourself, you nut. They cut back to Cliffy B in the AMD green room just to talk about Battlefront. Talked a little bit about Lawbreakers, which is the game that he announced not too long ago.
Looks a lot better than Battlefront.
Apparently told about people taking drugs and they get superpowers because it's the end of the world. The world blew up or
that's
something.
That's what happens when you take drugs, right? Yeah.
It does.
You guys should see me on PCP.
I'm super good at StarCraft.
Smoke this, so we're going to have a problem.
They had the Games for Impact Award, which is all about, you know, like raising awareness of X, Y, or Z. Life is Strange won that game of the year award. I had to finish that sentence right there.
Narc didn't win it.
They also had Best Fan Creation, which was Portal Stories, people that made some mod about Portal. Conan O'Brien actually had the award for Developer of the Year, which was pretty funny, where he just talked about how he didn't know anything about games.
And that game sucked. That's all he does. That's his shtick, but it's great.
And the Developer of the Year was CD Projekt Red, who, of course, released The Witcher. So that was actually
The Witcher?
Cool. Mm-hmm. They had the world premiere of Rock Band Oculus, Rock Band VR.
Rockulous?
It's
baby.
Yeah, you guys can have that one for free.
So what happened in this trailer was that it was the people from Rock Band pretending to learn how to be rock stars from Dragon Force, and I don't know, slightly amusing. They cut to some footage of Rock Band Oculus. I'm actually a little skeptical on VR. Huge Rock Band fan. Was a little bit disappointed by 4. This footage really opened up my eyes to be like, wow, Harmonix is not doing well. What is that? I cannot imagine. Exactly what you've already seen in Rock Band from like the Xbox 360 in first person, like the same crowds and everything. Mm-hmm. And it was first person holding this guitar. They didn't show how the interface worked at all. Like none of the footage. It was just somebody playing with a plastic guitar. And then Palmer Luckey took the stage to be like, yep, I've been working with Harmonix. So this is a real deal, big budget Oculus game. Oculus is supporting this. So think about that.
So like it's just Rock Band, but you can look down and see the guitar in your hands?
Yes. Like, you can look up and see some girl like, you're playing it wrong.
Listen, I love music games. Music games on VR sounds fantastic to me. This looked like shit. And I don't, you know, I don't use that lightly. This looked like shit. I love Rock Band. This was very disappointing. But it's still very early. Hopefully they get a hold of themselves because they need to go to church and figure out a few things.
Find God.
Coming in 2016. Yes. And Palmer Luckey said that, you know, he's happy to be there. He can't smash his plastic guitar.
He can't smash it soon enough.
I don't know. Phil Spencer was on there for Best Art Direction. That award went to Ori and the Blind Forest. Worth noting that Rise of the Tomb Raider was not nominated for this award. That baffles me because it actually was nominated for other things. Great art direction, Rise of the Tomb Raider. So good for Ori and the Blind Forest. We got the world premiere of Shadow Complex Remastered, which is free on PC for the next month.
Mm-hmm.
It is coming to Xbox One. It is coming to PlayStation 4.
Should I bother with it?
Hold on there, buddy.
Okay.
This is a big deal. Shadow Complex was an Xbox 360 exclusive from Epic Games that I believe was funded by Microsoft. So that's actually a pretty big deal that they're like, yeah, we're bringing it to PS4. Like, they had to buy their way out. Mm-hmm. Not since Mass Effect 1 have I heard of such an exclusive coming to a Sony platform. So very big deal there.
Yeah.
That's a good game, though.
It is. If you like Metroid, it's Metroid.
Whenever I play Metroid, I'm like
Metroid.
This is okay. I need a little bit more story, and it has to be written by like a notorious homophobe. Like, give me some of that, mm-hmm. And there you go.
Are you talking about the guy who did Skull Monkeys?
Oh, that's different. No. That's
him
guy.
Too. He's also got a new game that came out like a month ago. So there you go.
Nut
I'm glad case. I didn't hear about it.
Keith Sutherland took the stage for the Industry Icon Award, which
Solid
was
Snake
for
himself.
Brett Spiri and Lewis Castle, the founders of Westwood, the developer of things like Dune 2, which would later become, you know, Command and Conquer, the creators of RTS, mm-hmm. Ergo, the creator of MOBA, if you follow it along that logic, which, you know, come on. If you're going to give somebody that award, pretty fucking good choice.
Yeah, I'd say so.
I mean, they have a conscience. Last year was the people that created King's Quest. It was the couple that did that. So this award, I think, is
a couple again.
It was they're a couple. Yeah, they're super adorable and old, and I guess they make wine now.
Sierra Games, like the wife, she wrote like the first like 8 King's Quest games or something like that, or 7.
I need you to speak up, Steve.
That sounds very tasteful. So
yeah, it's.
I need you to speak up
good.
So much, Steve. Just aim for the microphone.
I don't know what to tell you.
You're doing great. Now you're doing great. There we go. Hey, we got a world premiere. Rocket League is coming to Xbox One. It's going to have a Halo and Gears of War car in it. Rocket League, Xbox One. That's a big deal.
You know, Rocket League's a lot of fun, but the other cars that you can get is stupid. Who cares?
The other cars you can get is stupid. Very good.
Yeah, you know, it's like, oh, Back to the Future car. Okay, it doesn't change anything. Nothing matters.
February 2016, look forward to that. Bonnie Ross actually was talking with Jeff Keighley backstage and mentioned the Cartographer's Gift. More maps, more
Cartographer.
Rep packs, more stuff for Forge, all this new stuff coming to Halo 5, so get out your wallets and buy it. No, free. Every month they're going to have new content for Halo 5, and it sounds like the first one is going to be pretty big and free. You got any credit there? You know?
Free, I can get behind that.
Mark Hamill took the stage for...
Who's Mark Hamilton?
For Best Action Adventure Game.
Just kidding.
And the Best Action Adventure Game of the award was Metal Gear Solid 5, Phantom Pain. Kiefer Sutherland walks up the stage.
It's Kiefer.
And everyone's going, why are you giving this guy the award? Where's Hideo Kojima? Jeff Keighley actually talked directly to the camera saying that they were contacted by lawyers. Kojima was not able to attend.
Oh, don't die. Why am I laughing?
You got to hit that cough button you got here.
Oh, my God. What is that? Oh, my God. It's the idiot. Oh. Of the week.
God.
Oh, my God.
This
is
a little bit early for this.
The idiot of the week has snuck in early right here. And
Digetic idiot of the week.
It is Konami because they would not allow Kojima to attend the Game Awards nor any other award ceremony to accept awards for Metal Gear Solid 5, The Phantom Pain. He is currently under contract by Konami.
Woof. Jesus.
Jesus fucking Christ.
Well, you know he's probably just kicking his feet up in Hawaii right now.
Is that what he's doing?
Yeah, he's bringing a Mai Tai. He's sitting on the beach.
He was in Japan, apparently. That's what they said. Oh. Jeff Keighley said, you know, we wish you all the best. Konami is just like, nope, you can't go anywhere. You can't accept the awards.
To Konami's PR, every single time they make an announcement or they do something, it's like, oh, this is literally the dumbest PR move I've ever seen. And then you just wait a week and they do something else. Later that week,
they did a tweet of some sort that basically alluded to them being demons. And then they took it down.
Do you think they're Seifer? Isn't that what it's called?
Oh, what happened is Justin Seifer was so good with the microphone.
In the video in Metal Gear Solid, isn't that the name of the villain, Seifer?
Inside the mic, not the top of the mic.
Seifer?
Inside the
Seether?
Mic. Inside the mic.
Seether.
There you, see, you can hear you now.
All you
right.
can hear me all along, you bastard.
No, you guys, I'm trying so hard here. So Konami, they are stupid. They are reckless.
We can go back to this.
They are cruel. They are petty. They are...
gamblers.
They
have a drug problem.
They are supporting the Yakuza of Japan with their pachinko machines, and they
we
are.
We shouldn't support them by playing their games, guys.
The absolute dumbass motherfucking idiot of the week. Had to get that out.
You heard it here first, guys.
Yeah, Konami's terrible.
Dumb motherfuckers. Anyway, okay.
We tried to tell you.
Jade Raymond took the stage, talking about performances, and even said, who could forget the voice of Solid Snake without David Hayter?
I know, right?
No, but that's so great. She was like, not Kiefer Sutherland, David Hayter. Thought that was amazing.
I thought Kiefer was pretty decent, though.
That's true.
Sound just like him.
We had, for the best performance, Witcher 3, Viva Shepherd in Witcher... Oh, that's a guy.
Viva Shepherd is a guy?
No. Here, I'll take it back. Best performance, they announced Witcher 3 and Viva Shepherd. Then the woman from Her Story took the stage and accepted the award for Her Story, thanking the writer for the script, and then cut to Jeff Keighley, goes, yep, that was the best performance for Her Story. Her Story. Viva for Her Story. Because Jade Raymond accidentally said Witcher 3.
Oh, Jesus.
I know.
That's embarrassing.
And she was like...
Big mistake.
I think it was a typo on the card, because she was like, Viva Shepherd for Witcher 3? You can actually hear it. Go look it up. It's amazing. according to my notes, what the fuck is going on here? They had a world premiere for, yet again, Telltale, Walking Dead, Mikon. Apparently that's the name. It's going to be 3 episodes starting in February 2016.
That's the girl with the sword on the show.
Yeah, the girl with the sword.
Some guy from South Carolina in another short film about Unity creators. His name is Tom Brush. He's making a game called Pinstripe. It's about an ex-minister who goes to hell.
That could be okay.
Yeah, it looked pretty interesting. Finally, Jeff Keighley took the stage for the game of the year. It was The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt, and they closed it out with Deadmau5. Guys, overall impression, or what you got, Steve?
Can I wanted to ask a question about the game of the year thing, because I thought it was interesting that Witcher 3 won, because that seems like it's the game that everybody's just like, oh yeah, it's really good, but like nobody's like losing their shit over. Like, it's not very divisive. It's just kind of like the steady middle of the road thing. Do you know how they voted for this? I know there was like a panel of like 50 or so game journalists and stuff.
Yeah, and so it's panelists from things like Polygon, IGN, Bomb, GameSpot, all those people.
I'm wondering, like, and I don't know if they disclosed any of this at all, like how the process works. But is it like the type of thing where you have your five games that you can choose from and you rank them 1 through 5?
I'm not.
Just pick the one, or
I'm not positive, but I could totally imagine Witcher 3 winning regardless.
Yeah,
just because the journalists really like that game. I mean, we're talking tens, actual tens. Like GameSpot gave it a 10. Like, what? This does not happen.
But old white men.
Well, you know, and so Witcher 3. Honestly, if you're a fan of Witcher 3, you're in all the way. Like all the way. It's it's a phenomenon, more so than Fallout, more so than anything else. So Witcher 3. Game of the year, not really a surprise. Okay, guys, let's go over to the PlayStation Experience, which I think we'll see a little bit more announcements. Here's what we got.
Live in your world, play in ours.
I'm just skipping a lot of this stuff because they had like some intro. It was like straight out of the 90s where like a black and white grain footage of this old guy being like, back in my day, we had arcades and blah, blah, blah.
Sounds like a Sega commercial from the 90s.
It really was. Mm-hmm. It really, truly was. And then they would cut to game footage. We had our very first trailer kicking off the show because this is all about game announcements. And it showed Drake. He was at his desk. Somebody's knocking on the door. He's like, we're closed. Opens up the door. It's his brother, Sam, which if you played the multiplayer beta, you can already play as Sam in that beta. They go outside and he's like, I thought you were dead, blah, 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 blah. And he goes, well, what have you been up to, Drake? And that's when a conversation tree appears. And you can choose from one of the three conversations, which is different for that's never been
in Uncharted.
That's never been in Naughty Dog games.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Period. That's a huge deal. What do you guys think about that? Is that a better way for storytelling in Uncharted, or is that
doesn't everybody hate these things?
Well, Uncharted, it's a more linear series. So with something like, you know, like Fallout or Mass Effect or something like that, where
why is Colin so excited about this?
He loves Fallout and Mass Effect. With games like that, it's all about like choice and kind of crafting your own character and your own narrative. But if this is a linear narrative driven game, I don't know if dialogue trees will really change anything, because it's not going to drastically alter
the
outcome. Yeah, it'll change the dialogue.
Like
it's like Fallout 4 when you can choose between yes, yes, no, or sarcasm.
And the sarcasm just makes the guy get mad at you, and then he won't tell you anything anymore.
Exactly.
Well, it is going to, I mean, hopefully it's going to be something interesting. Like,
nice joke there, prick.
Maybe somebody's dangling from a cliff or whatever, and it's like, Drake, go on without me. And you can either say, no, 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 or fine. Maybe you can kill off characters. It is, apparently, they said this is going to be the last in the series, so maybe giving characters more influence over the story, because fuck it, it's over. We don't have to worry about a sequel. That could be an interesting idea.
Yeah.
I don't know. I hope so. I hope. Sean Layden took to the stage. He's wearing a goddamn classic Crash Bandicoot shirt like he always does at these events, even though there's never Crash Bandicoot news. I guess he just represents the spirit.
Why is there no more Crash Bandicoot, by the way?
Activision owned
it. Side panel. Oh, goddamn it, Activision.
Because Vivendi owned it, and then Activision was owned by Vivendi. It's
give it back to Naughty Dog.
Just give it to him.
And then you're gonna give it to him.
Get out,
Naughty Dog. No. Sean Layden was having a great time. He was basically playing Santa at the parade, if you know what I'm saying.
Yeah,
and,
as far as I remember.
He cut to the fan reaction of the Final Fantasy VII trailer from E3. Lots of people crying and freaking out. So they actually showed off a new trailer with actual gameplay. Final Fantasy VII is Final Fantasy XV gameplay. It's not turn-based.
Yeah, I noticed that too. Stupid. Like, It's not really, I mean, I guess this is it's a remake, it's not a remastering.
Absolutely.
But it's a totally different game. I guess the story is still the same, but it's like, hey, you know that story that you might have liked from that JRPG? What if it was a totally different thing?
And now let's get Cloud to talk a lot more. Like, people will come up to him and he's like, no.
Dude, Barrett actually we should talk about what we saw in the trailer. It was in Midgar, and we saw the way that you actually have to walk around, and it's very close camera. It's very ground level camera, so the building's very tall, and you can see how tall. It looks a lot like Resident Evil 4 in a way, the way that the camera controls. They actually showed Cloud squeezing through a crack. It was very interactive, you know, almost like Tomb Raider. So not just walking around and looking for the door to click open. Barrett sounds a lot like Jet from Cowboy Bebop. I'm pretty sure it's the same voice actor.
And he looks like Wesley Snipes in Blade.
He has sunglasses. I know he had sunglasses, but he's got he was rocking them. So the gameplay, the fighting, they were fighting against some soldiers.
It looked
soldiers.
Like Kingdom Hearts, man.
I'm
like, what is this shit? Get it out of here.
Okay, that's one way to look at it. You didn't like it?
I think it looks terrible, and I think they're going to ruin the storyline, and I just hate it.
But
I'll play it, though. Okay. I'll play it and hate it.
I guess...
You're going to hate play something?
You're going to hate play it? Don't you ever do that?
I don't know what to think. Like, if you love Final Fantasy VII... Why don't you just play Final Fantasy VII? Like, why would I want to... I don't understand.
I'm so glad you said that, because they also announced that the PlayStation 4 version, the PC version of Final Fantasy VII was on the PlayStation 4. It was released at the very moment that they made that announcement. I guess the thing is that, you know, no one wants turn-based RPGs anymore.
I do.
No one. It's weird.
What about
Not
me?
Not one person.
I Not do. A single person.
Wants
what about me, guys? They forgot about
RPGs
me.
RPGs that are turn-based.
What, can we redo Final Fantasy VI Remastered and not add some shitty Kingdom Hearts gameplay to it?
Okay, I thought it looked good. I honestly thought it looked fine.
It's a minute,
I don't know what to think. Like, I think it looks beautiful. It looks absolutely gorgeous.
It does.
The frame rate obviously wasn't all there. It's a work in progress.
I just, like, I don't
the
know
one thing it had going for it.
What to do with it. I just literally don't know what to do with it.
Mm. When's it going to come out? Like, 2 years? This is just a tech demo.
Well, it's Square Enix, so it could come out in 2 weeks or 9 years.
Well, the team behind it there, what is that exactly?
I just don't know how you're going to fight Ruby Weapon with the
Tetsuya Nomura.
Gameplay
Tetsuya
thing.
Nomura is involved in the game, and he has a track record of taking his time with games.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, when Square Enix announces like release dates, they actually have a dartboard, and they just kind of throw shit.
Okay, we're doing that one next week.
Shelby Cox took the stage, and I don't mean to typecast her, but she looked like she would host one hell of a good kid's birthday party. I don't know. She seemed very warm.
What she dressed as a clown or something?
No, she just seemed like a very warm. She's like, oh, we're all here just for video games. She was clapping. It's like, oh, you seem like a nice person. You know, you seem like a cool person. I'd like to hang out.
Really? You just want to bang her.
So,
what the fuck?
She announced that Black Ops 3... broke nearly every record on PlayStation 4 launches. She announced that the DLC Awakening will arrive 30 days before anywhere else. How about that?
Yay.
How about that? Nowhere else. No one else gets it.
Awakening.
It's just for you guys.
And they also announced that the Sony and the PlayStation brand are going to be partnering with Activision's Call of Duty World League, a brand new esports league exclusively for Call of Duty. So that was pretty interesting. There's a $3 million prize pool. She also brought up Star Wars and showed off a trailer showing all the highlights of other players online, their best moments on Star Wars Battlefront.
Here's this where this guy killed Luke Skywalker. Look at this.
Then Randy Pitchford took to the stage, everybody's favorite.
Randy Pitchford? Say it again. What's his name?
Randy Pitchford. You don't know Randy Pitchford?
I think his name is funny.
Yeah, we.
You might know him as guy who like boldface lied about.
He does not lie. He gives you the old pitcheroo.
The old that, pitcher. Have you trademarked
that? That is an original. That's it. That's a CT original.
It's a
CT Industries
PC.
He's like the M. Night Shyamalan video games, because you think you're getting something good, and then he gives you a twist of Rooski.
Oh, like Omari.
He introduced himself by saying, "We brought you Borderlands." Didn't mention Aliens, Colonial Marines. Didn't mention Duke Nukem Forever. He talks about the importance of new franchises. He's got, obviously, Battleborn. He calls it a hero shooter. 25 playable characters. He introduced it's made by the team that made Battleborn, Borderlands. That was an interesting flub of the night.
Battle Borderlands?
Yeah.
Battleborn's made by the team that made Battleborn.
He kept reiterating, I want to make sure you understand. He kept saying that phrase. I want to make sure you understand that it is a...
It's a weird tick.
It does have split-screen co-op. So you can play it locally.
That's cool.
Open beta, early 2016 on PlayStation 4. PS4 beta players will get a bonus character. And then they reveal the brand new character named Toby. Toby is a penguin in a giant mech suit. And yeah.
Nice. Cool. I get behind that.
May 3rd, 2016, if you want to put up with it. Up next, we had Street Fighter V. They had a brand new trailer introducing their final character for the launch. His name is Fang. He's a very odd person. He almost dresses like a southern minister with a very long face and a hat. And he does a lot of air combos.
Shao Kahn? What is his name? The villain from Mortal Kombat?
Shang Tsung?
Shang Tsung?
Shang Tsung?
Why do they have stupid names?
Why can't you say Shang Tsung?
Shang Tsung.
you still can't say it.
Keep saying it.
Shang Kun? Shang Kun.
I'm
not even doing it on purpose.
Now you're just playing Santa at the parade.
I'm always Santa at the parade.
All right. Well, we had a very awesome boxing intro where they revealed that Yoshiori Ono was actually there. He had these big fake fists that were like Ryu. He had the bandana. And he's like, this is the first time we've been able to show a character without a leak. So that was pretty amazing. They're going to have more characters that you can purchase afterwards, after the game releases, including Alex from Street Fighter 3, Guile, Balrog, Ibuki, I'm not sure that is, Juri, who is in Street Fighter 4, she was one of the DLC characters, and Yuren. They're all going to be
after Yuren?
My favorite character.
What? It's
Is he green? Is he
it's
the green
Japan.
Guy?
Japan.
You probably just said it wrong.
I don't know. Do you care about any of these characters? That's his name.
How do you spell Yuren?
U-R-I-E-N. It's Yuren.
No, Yurian.
All right, fine. You're going to go with that.
Yuren.
All characters can be earned, Yuren. But you can also buy a season pass, which is already available right now. Gio Corsi actually went to the stage to tell Ono to stop talking, and then he got beat up by Ono's fake fists.
Hey, Ono, stop talking. What are you doing? No, don't hit me.
Gio Corsi, a.k.a. the best friend of the Vita, took to the stage. And he revealed that, he just talked a little bit about Dead Star. It's a twin-stick shooter in space.
You know how we like those twin-stick shooters, right?
You have a home ship. Every player is a home ship, and other players can attack your home ship. So, take that.
Stay away from my ship.
They also revealed that they have a partnership with Adult Swim Games, where they showed off a ton of different games, including one called Death's Gambit, basically like Dark Souls in 2D. Hmm. Very interesting. Very pretty. Raise the Dead as an R-A-Y. Apostrophe S, Raise the Dead. So Ray has a game called The Dead or something like that. You might remember this game from E3 2013 when they were doing that whole indie show. They also showed up Duck Game. It's a 2D platformer.
Duck Game is so good.
Rain World, which is another 2D platformer. And then something called Small Radios Big Television that just showed a bunch of TVs and buildings rotating. And then lastly, Double Fine's Headlander. It's a sci-fi 2D platformer with analog shooting. Kind of looks like a very bizarro version of the Swapper, if that works for you. Duck Game is good. Do you like Duck Game?
It's so good. It's basically a super simplified, goofy version of Smash Brothers.
Mm.
It's amazing.
From what I understand, all of these games, and maybe some of them, not all of them, are going to be coming to the PlayStation 4 for sure, but also to the Vita. Mm-hmm. So that's going to be interesting. Yeah, and then Tim Schafer actually took to the stage to goof off a little bit and showed off some new footage of Day of the Tentacle remastered.
I'm excited.
Pretty exciting.
It's coming to the Vita. It's coming to the PlayStation 4. And it basically had the exact same frame rate. They just touched it up. So it was cool. It was like they didn't fix anything. If you don't remember, like they would do the animation in like threes. So it would be a little bit choppier. They also revealed that Full Throttle will be coming to PlayStation 4 and Vita.
I'm more excited about that than Day of the Tentacle because
I beat Full Throttle and I beat Day of the Tentacle, and back in the day, adventure games were hard, and I love that.
They
and that's
were
before
so
you could
hard.
Just you. Could, I mean, you could just look it up, but like that was not your first instinct. You
no,
know?
I remember I printed a FAQ off of the game FAQs page for Day of the Tentacle. I had like this 100-page long like guide that I would have to flip through to find the.
And people don't realize either. Not to get too like old man back in my day, but seriously, like even if you wanted to. You know, Yahoo search tips for a game.
They let you Yahoo search? I only could Yahooligan search.
Yahooligan search, yeah.
It
wasn't like now where like there's a game FAQ and there's forums and there's Reddit. It was just like, oh God, I got to like slog through all this crap and then use some shady fan site to figure out how to get through this part.
It was a nightmare back
some
in the
day. Some self-promotional guy wrote his own, guide for it where you keep saying like, Gilbo's the best.
PayPal me $3 and you can download this text file.
We got our next announcement. Rhombus of Ruin.
Rhombus of Ruin?
The Psychonauts VR experience coming to PlayStation VR in 2016.
That's a long time. I'm going to wait.
I can't hear you.
That's a long time from now.
There we go, buddy.
I think I'm going to have to wait.
Okay. Fantastic. Really, guys, we're talking about a VR game based around Psychonauts. It's Psychonauts year, it seems like. This is, the game Psychonauts 2 will not be out in 2016, but Rhombus of Ruin will be out. What's going on here?
They're just going to saturate the market, huh?
I'm just a little baffled. I mean, they must have done their market research to really be like, let's go all out with this. I mean, I'm not sure where this is coming from.
Is this one kickstarted or no?
No, this is just going to be available. I assume that Sony had some funding in the project because it is coming to PlayStation VR.
Yeah.
Obviously, it'll come to Oculus and other things, but that's all we know at the moment. We had a trailer for Invisible Inc. It was basically hipsters fighting against an oppressive government coming in 2016. Don't Starve Together, which is Don't Starve, but with co-op. Mm. Is that already out on PC?
Yeah. I don't know if it's out yet, but I have like a beta or something on Steam that I was playing. And Invisible Inc. is really, really, really good.
Is there, 'cause the trailer looked awful.
It's amazing. It's kind of like XCOM mixed with Metal Gear VR missions in a lot of ways. So it's everything you didn't like about Volume. It gets rid of that.
So wait, what's it called again?
It's called Invisible Inc.
That's weird. I've never seen it.
No.
Have you ever used Inc. before?
But yeah, it's basically like a stealth action game with XCOM turn-based shit.
South African game?
Yeah, it's South African. No, it's fucking good.
Split screen for Don't Starve Together coming to the PlayStation 4. Zodiac Oricannon Odyssey. Made up words. Why? Because it's a Japanese game that was developed with people that worked on Final Fantasy VII and Final Fantasy Tactics. Basically some sort of 2D platformer with a girl riding a griffin, turn-based combat. It was a real blend of Western fantasy and just slight anime influence. It really looked like something special. So keep your eyes posted.
I will play
peeled.
That. Keep Close, your eyes. Keep your posts.
Everyone, keep your eyes.
Keep your eyes, guys.
Keep them. Don't give them away. Don't.
You're going to need them.
You find the girl of your dreams, you give her those eyes. Hitman Go is coming to the PlayStation 4 and Vita.
What?
Yeah.
Why?
Well, because the other version's free to play.
But then you can't go if it's on your PlayStation 4.
Well,
yeah, you can use
it's not Hitman on the go anymore.
But I'll play on my Vita.
Well, that's fine then.
Okay.
Hitman Stay. Stay. Stay.
Brawlhalla is coming to the PlayStation 4. No idea what that is.
Brawlhalla? I can tell you what that is. It's a game about Vikings in a bar.
Okay. Yakuza 5 is actually coming out this Tuesday. It was supposed to be out in November, remember? It's coming out this Tuesday. It's going to be $40 on PSN, only on PlayStation 3. All right, cool. I mean, they finally are releasing that. Oh, wait, there's more. Yakuza 0 that's on the PlayStation 4 is coming to America. Holy shit. I did not see that coming.
That's sweet.
That's incredible. They haven't even released Yakuza 5 yet. They're like, oh, okay, yeah, let's do it. That's hashtag thank you, Sony, for doing that.
Hashtag
Sony did some other stupid stuff, but that part I'll be like,
I'll forget about the dumb stuff.
They are going to be bringing Last Blade 2, the classic fighting game, to the PlayStation 4 and Vita, so you don't have to worry about your Dreamcast copies anymore, children.
Oh, thank God.
Showed off some footage for King of Fighters 14. This is the one that has 3D models, the very first time in the series history, and it looks and performs, you know, just like 2D. It doesn't have the art anymore, but like the way the characters react are very stiff, like a 2D fighting game, so that was good news. Anyway,
that's cool.
They showed a trailer for a brand new game called N-I-O-H. Noi.
N-I-O-H.
Noi.
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 Yeah.
It's Neo. Developed by Team Ninja, and it basically looked like The Witcher mixed with Onimusha. It was like a dark and spooky Japanese
city. Sounds
very
ambitious.
Very stiff-looking combat. Very dodging, //, dodge, //. So not like you're flying around in the air.
It's funny. You just use stiff as a compliment, and then you use it as a negative.
What?
Yeah, it was a compliment towards the fighting game, but then you don't want to see stiff.
No, they both look great.
Oh, really? Stiff is good?
Stiff can be good if it's in the,
stiff's great, let me tell you.
me and Steve are going to show you how stiff can be good.
I'm stiff right now.
Stiff can be right.
Stiff as hell.
I think you took it too far, guys.
Stiff
for
tonight.
Stiff tonight. Stiff tonight. Okay.
Get your stiffy out.
So when I get stiff, hey, yeah, then it go to.
You cannot. No, you've got nothing.
Oh, I got nothing, but I figured out a beat.
You figured out 4/4. That is great. You
that
figured
out.
Four,
you were four. Clapping in it. You're like Steve Martin in The Jerk, trying to figure out how to keep a rhythm.
Sid Schumann and Nick Stuckner took to the stage to announce that Bastion is available on the Vita and is only $3 up until the 15th, I want to say, which is pretty amazing.
Then it skyrockets.
The Bit Trip collection is available on PlayStation 4 and Vita for only $10. And then Nuclear Throne was already available on PlayStation 4 and Vita. Nuclear Throne, it's just out. There it is. It's out right now.
It's great. Go play it.
Why don't you tell me a little bit about it?
I'm going to tell you all about it. It's a procedurally generated action game where basically it sort of plays like if Akari Warriors was mixed with like a bullet hell shooter with procedurally generated levels, and you kill monsters. You kill all the monsters once the screen is clear. Then a portal opens up, takes you out. After you kill a monster, they drop radiation. You collect the radiation. It works like experience. You can level up 10 times. When you level up, you get to pick from perks that, like, you know, health packs give you more health, or you can shoot faster, things like that. Each of the characters that you have also have their own stats and their own special abilities. It's so much fun. It's hard as balls. It's got great personality and awesome, awesome music. The intro music is amazing.
Such a Steve game.
I noticed that you didn't compare it to Binding of Isaac.
It's kind of, well, I mean, Isaac is a little more meditative and like,
I got my Steve checklist, which is it randomly generated? Yeah. There we go. We're getting closer, you know.
That's what I love.
Is it developed by a small team?
I like this stuff too.
Flamber is great. They made Ridiculous Fishing and they made Love Browsers.
Ooh.
Which are both great games. Mm. And it should be said too, this game is in early access on PC, and they do early access right. They never put the game on sale until it's actually out. Mm-hmm. Like it's never like, oh, 50% off.
Well, it looks like they're out now.
I guess it's out now. But I mean, like, they never do discounts for Steam things because they don't think that that's good for early access. Also, they do live streams of the development of the game. Like, watch them, like, fix bugs and draw characters and play through the game.
Just to make
Twitch.
Sure they're doing it. That's cool.
Yeah, like, somebody made
quit
that
slacking
game, right?
Off. Quit eating that sandwich.
But it's cool because, like, you never get like that kind of an inside look at game development. It's pretty nifty.
We got a new trailer for this. Well, we got the announcement, the reveal of Brutal, which is a third person combat game that's like, you know, fantasy, except the fantasy is literally built out of early 80s PC RPGs, like the ones just single screen RPGs, like,
mm-hmm.
So it looks like a combination of Tron without any of the color and like a third person action game. So we're talking like the dragon is made out of dots. Like it looks bonkers cool. Looks really, really interesting. Don't know anything about it. Got another trailer for MLB The Show. Got to see somebody bullet time dive for a catch. That'll be March 29th. If you've never played MLB The Show, but you have the slightest interest in baseball, I really do recommend it. It is
Makes baseball a lot more exciting.
It's really good. And besides that, the name of my character, and I actually had the announcer announce it when I played 2015, was Boof Big Dog. Coming up to the plate, Boof Big Dog.
One of my favorite fake names in video games was always Ulf Folk. So it's really hard to say for the announcers.
Well, I like the sports games from a few years ago where you couldn't just put anything in. They just had a list of like, here are the names that we can actually say. So you just find
you
like I had a guy
work,
when I played like the last college basketball game. My backcourt was Yaya Israel and Fats Falou.
As soon as you mention basketball, Justin gets a little up.
I like Fats Ballou and yeah, Israel. Oh, folk.
Scott Rohde took to the stage to reveal Guns Up, build a base, build your troops, fight with other players, whatever. It's free to play. It's on your PlayStation 4 right now. It looks like an RTS with a third quarter portrait. Then we got Fat Princess Adventures, sequel to Fat Princess, 4-player local co-op and online co-op, and it's out right now. It's a dungeon crawler. It's out. It's already out there. Ted Price went on stage to show some more gameplay of Ratchet & Clank, and it looks quite good. Very different from the original. It retells the story of the original, but the way that they showed him finding Clank and then having a whole mission to get back to his base, as opposed to the original game, which is like, I don't know, you jump up 3 stairs.
There's Clank.
Lots of different enemies, gunships, creatures. The disco gun is back. New levels. It really does seem pretty interesting. It's going to be out on April 12th, just ahead of the movie. Then Dr. Richard Marks took to the stage to show off this VR demo where two players were standing on pillars against each other and they had to throw discs at each other. And they could actually ricochet off the walls.
Kind of like Tron?
Yeah, someone would fall off the pillar. It looked like it would be maybe interesting if any of it fucking worked. Literally, his arms didn't work when he was on stage. He goes, oh, my arms aren't working. Hey, don't hit me with that thing. I mean, it looked like a glitchy fucking mess.
Yeesh. But it's coming out, right?
Oh, no, the whole thing's coming out in 2016.
I'm
that looks great.
Out.
Hey, no, I honestly think Sony right now, they're doing so well financially. They need to invest it all into VR because that is going to turn out well. Let me tell you. we got PlayStation Now.
It's going to be like 3D TV.
Skipping it up.
3D TV. Remember how successful that was?
Oh, and then they supported that. I mean, seriously, Sony, what the fuck are you doing? And I'm going to buy this son of a bitch because I'm going to have to do videos on VR now.
You're like, oh, I hate this so much. How do you do videos of VR? Well,
it's just a webcam looking at Colin. He's just like, whoa,
this game sucks.
Oh man, if you guys could see this.
Oh, I'm really worried. I don't know if I'm going to be able to pull it off because I think like it might freak out with the HDCP. Fuck, I don't know. We'll have to see.
Maybe you need a 2-neutron composer for your.
If I can separate the video output from the VR output, I'll be okay. But I'm a little worried about it. So maybe I won't do any videos on.
What if pirates hijack your CPU though? It's hackers reference.
Yeah, they're going to take over my head, you know.
Max Headroom.
Rez is coming to PlayStation VR. Rez, the Dreamcast game, is back. And they actually had the creator from Rez wearing like a Daft Punk suit, wearing the VR helmet, actually playing the game live on stage.
Dude, Rez is like the McRib of video games. It's always back.
You know, the funny thing about Rez, if I'm not mistaken,
good one, Steve.
They came up with the name while they were at Burning Man. True story.
That's probably
you know what
right.
Rez refers to, right?
Mm.
No, when you, the stuff that's left, the residue that's left over in a weed pipe.
That is not why they call it
Rez. Yeah,
he
smoked some Rez, you know, like, oh, we got some Rez here. No, you never hung out with some stupid stoners that are like,
you never smoked Rez, dude?
Let me just scrape all these glass shards into something.
Hey, let me invite you into my small apartment, and I got this Bob Marley poster.
I'm
it's
all
the
out
cover
of weed,
a legend.
But we can smoke some Rez.
Yeah, you want your mouth to taste like ass for like a month?
You want to scrape this bowl, man? You want to scrape this bowl? Look at my Bob Marley poster.
Oh man,
you know what else? I got this other poster. It's all the Pink Floyd albums, but it's butts. It's butts that are painted with Pink Floyd albums.
I hate that fucking.
It's the back catalog. Get it?
You guys will watch Boondock Saints.
Yeah, let's watch wait, Boondock Saints and blaze one.
What was that hipster game studio we were making fun of a couple weeks ago?
Save it.
What is it called again?
Save it. We'll come to it later. Okay. Boys and Asad Quizzlebash. I can't remember his fucking name. I'm sorry, dude.
Asad Quizzlebash?
They showed off some more. They showed off more VR, including Ubisoft's Eagle Flight. You are an eagle that flies through the air, and there are other players that will fly with you. Then they showed off Sony Santa Monica's Modern Zombie Taxi Company. Did you see this? What's the name of that game where you're the bear driving the car?
I have no idea.
Is that from the Clerks animated series?
So it's a first-person game where the zombie apocalypse is over, and like zombies are actually just normal now. They just live a day-to-day life. And you run a taxi company where you drive a car in VR, and you have to drop your kids off at soccer practice, and you just brake and launch them through the windshield. It's just physics and stupidity. It looked really good. See, VR, that's how you get me interested, right there.
Works for me.
Just driving a stupid car.
Let's come up with something stupid and kind of like it.
Job Simulator will be coming to PlayStation VR. Highwire Games Golem, which is this interesting game with this little girl controlling a golem, that's coming to PlayStation VR. 100-foot robot golf is coming to PlayStation VR.
Oh, I'm so excited for that because that's made by the guys who made that crazy ass. That's another fucking driving game. You like drive this like limousine or something, but you're constantly like drifting in a circle. What's it like? Roundabout? Is that what it's called?
Is that what it, was it really Roundabout?
I don't know. I think that might
Roundabout
be the name.
Might be something different.
It might be something different.
That's,
I don't know.
Roundabout's the FMV game, sort of.
Okay, then that's not it then. But whatever it is, it's this hilarious game that is great.
100-foot robot golf involves you literally fighting other robots while playing golf. You can even be on the moon and launch your ball towards the Earth. It looks very good.
That sounds cool, like Katamari Damacy or something.
They closed it out with Ace Combat 7, an exclusive for PlayStation 4 and PlayStation VR. Very good.
That's lovely.
I'm getting a little excited here, guys.
Adam Boys then said there was going to be a brand new event in Destiny where you race your fucking sparrows. Who gives a shit?
That sounds stupid.
They showed off Hob. It's from the makers of Torchlight. It, you know, I don't know.
Also stupid.
Three-quarters portrait.
You don't
puzzle,
like Torchlight?
Puzzle exploration, melee combat, pulling blocks, platforming, activating platforms, blah, blah, blah. Then level 5 was mentioned. And dear God, this might be the best-looking PlayStation 4 game.
Oh, you feeling stiff?
Oh my, I'm feeling stiff.
It's a gameplay stiff, though?
It's about Evan.
It's about as stiff as it gets.
The boy king. There's a coup, and his protectors take him to another land to be raised by more rural people who still respect the monarchy while this evil rat-type guy took over. It was the announcement of Ni No Kuni 2.
Sounds like the new Shaq Fu.
Guys, seriously, hold on. Guys, you didn't watch the trailer.
No, I didn't.
If you watched the trailer, you'd be shitting your pants right now. Because I've never seen anything look this good.
I watched my girlfriend play through Ni No Kuni 1, and it was pretty fun.
No, deep down, if the trailers they're showing are actual gameplay or in-game models, I don't understand how it's possible.
Does it look like a Studio Ghibli movie or something?
No, the original looked like a very close representation. At certain angles, it looked like Studio Ghibli.
I meant the new one.
This really... I'm not even kidding. This really looks like... You have to see this trailer. It looks like animation. I don't understand how it can be 3D models when I'm watching it. It's insane.
Can we watch it right now?
No.
Yeah, right now.
Okay.
Sorry, podcast. Take a break.
So they closed out the show with two guys from Epic Games taking to the stage to announce Paragon. It's a MOBA, 5-on-5 third-person shooter.
Here we go again.
Another one of those. One guy opened up a wormhole and launched a giant rocket people.
Giant rocket people?
Mm-hmm. Just let me punch you. Just stare right there. and that was it. That was the PlayStation Experience. Guys, that's the end of the earth-shattering news.
That's how they ended it, with that?
Yeah. So here we go. What do we got to ask right here? Video Game Awards versus Sony Experience. Ni No Kuni 2. Psychonauts 2. Psychonauts VR versus Rock Band VR. What do you guys think? What do you think was the more significant show right here? Obviously, one is pertaining to a particular set of platforms, while the other one was more universal. But overall, which one of these had more things that perked your interest?
Steve, go. I think the Sony thing was more interesting because this sort of PlayStation event, it's almost like a practice round for E3. But because Sony is kind of the industry leader right now by a really wide margin, they're going to be almost like the pace car for what we're going to see in video games for the next 5 years. So by looking at them and what they're going to be doing with VR, and let me hold your hand, and what they're doing with their PlayStation 4 stuff and their Vita stuff, like this is the direction that the industry is going in. I mean, it is obviously it's a big PR circle jerk, but I mean, the Video Game Awards were also a PR advertising circle jerk. So if I'm going to choose a circle jerk, the Sony one interests me more.
All right, very good. Justin.
But you're interested in circle jerks.
I am very interested in circle jerks.
Justin, the VGAs, or I'm sorry, the Game Awards with Jeff Keighley, or the PlayStation Experience.
It's an easy one for me, guys. The PlayStation Awards.
Fantastic.
No, the PlayStation Experience. I got the PlayStation, so I'm more excited about this stuff. Ni No Kuni, that sounds incredible. I gotta do it.
I think it's safe to say, though, I mean...
Is that going to be turn-based, do you know?
Oh, of course, yeah.
Yes, just like good. The other one. Yes, good.
I mean, I hope so. Mm-hmm. I mean, but it's level 5. That's what they produce. Guys, I also am going to go with the PlayStation Experience, but I don't want to underrepresent the significance of the Game Awards with something like Psychonauts 2, with something like Rock Band VR, and having Palmer Luckey on stage to discuss that. That's some pretty big deal, you know? That's some pretty big deal, if you ask me, guys. I mean, it...
Couldn't have pet it better myself.
But I mean, all in all, this was a huge week. We are literally haven't gotten to any of the segments and we're already an hour into the show.
Holy shit.
Because that's how big it was. All I can say is, you know.
How big is it?
Real big.
I'm so happy that we are now making December the second E3. I don't need quarterly E3s. I know we also have Gamescom, which actually did have some significant news, but I like keeping these things a little bit separate, you know? And also we had the Tokyo Game Show, and we also had, oh my God, maybe there are more announcements I can consider, but I would say that the PlayStation Experience, just for all the news we had about the Vita, really did make me quite happy. But I will still say, probably the biggest news of this week, if you had to say game announcements, goes to the Game Awards with Psychonauts 2 going to FIG. That is layers upon layers of interesting. We're talking about the way that things are going to be crowdsourced. We're talking about the way Double Fine is taking advantage of their nostalgia. It's a very fascinating story.
So, no Last Guardian news. None?
No. They said that if Justin asks one more time, it's canceled.
That's what they said. We're turning this car around.
Okay, guys. Well, that was it for the earth-shattering news.
Snooze.
You lose. All right. We have to take a break. I'm sorry. We'll go back to the hype train. We have much shorter segments coming up. Stay tuned after this. On today's episode of Pokemon, Bash Batchum and Pikachu are out in the forest to discover the mysterious Pokemon, Birdle.
Wow, man. This thing looks kind of like a turtle, but it's blue. It should be easy to find. You'd think it would stand out here in this pond.
Pikachu, Pika.
What's that, Pikachu?
Pika, Pika.
Oh, shit. It's Team Bucket. Bessie and Bames here to fuck our shit up.
Prepare for trouble. Make it double. Bessie. Bames. Team Rocket blast off at the speed of light. Surrender now or prepare to fight.
Beowth, that's right.
Beowth is here too, fuck that.
Oh god, I'm gonna take your Pikachu and just fuck it.
Unhand my Pikachu.
No, he's going to be all mine.
And mine too. And we're gonna take all of your stars from iTunes by review bombing the shit out of you.
We're not doing that shit. I've had up to here with this shit every fucking week, you little motherfucking syrup. Try and take me? You got nothing better to do with your life? trying to take away our iTunes reviews. Fuck that. Go to iTunes. Give us 5 stars. Give us a 5-star written review right now for the Pressure Cast. Sick of this shit.
I'm really sorry. We had tough childhoods.
Pikachu!
Please go to iTunes. Please go. Just go to iTunes.
Get there.
Get there.
5 stars.
Worst thing we ever did.
Welcome back to the show, everybody. Welcome back to the show. Guys, we have already gone through a lot of news, but it is time to talk about the biggest news stories other than the stuff we already talked about. Hurry up. Let's go. Here it comes. You ready? Did you got your stuff?
Yeah. Steve hasn't even met Roscoe yet, has he?
No, I think he has. Let's go. The train's coming.
Oh.
That's right. It's time for the Hype Train. Feel the PR vibrations as we barrel towards Video Game Satisfaction Station on the Hype Train. This is the part of the show where we talk about all those gosh darn new video games to get you all hyped up for the you know, spend all your money.
For the rest of the weekend.
Mm-hmm. We're kicking it off with PlayStation 4 now has PlayStation 2 emulation. Over the weekend, Sony started selling these games, including Dark Cloud, Grand Theft Auto 3, Grand Theft Auto Vice City, Grand Theft Auto San Andreas, Rogue Galaxy, The Mark of Kree, Twisted Metal Black, War of the Monsters, all available on PSN with Parappa the Rapper 2 and The King of Fighters 2000 to be added at a later date. They will support share play, remote play. They actually have trophies. You can have second screen app stuff. Holy crap.
Trophies.
And the games cost $9.99 or $14.99.
Well, I'm glad that Sony listens to the Pressure Cast, because if you remember, a couple weeks ago, I said I wanted Mark of Kree. And they gave it to me.
Flashback.
I love Mark of Kree. I adore Mark of Kree. These prices are way too goddamn high. $15? I mean, $15, actually.
Yeah. I mean, I guess they're sort of mimicking, like, when you buy a regular Wii game on Nintendo's
It's $20. E-shop, it's but that's $20. Last generation. I get it. $20. Last generation. I mean, these should all be $9.99.
What about
like
those game? Oh no, there are none.
Wait, is Dark Cloud? That's the snowboarding RPG, right? Snowboarding RPG?
No, that's the
Dreamcast game.
No, you build your whole world and stuff like that. Rogue Galaxy is a really good game though for JRPGs. So you might actually want. Isn't that's level 5? Isn't it? That's level 5. The guys are making Ni No Kuni 2, so maybe there's a reason behind that.
Maybe I should play it for clues.
Okay, doot. PlayStation. Later? No, my friends. It's PlayStation Now, and it's back in the house. PlayStation Now has a brand new system. Starting on December 8th, you'll be able to buy, for $100, 12-month access. All year, play all the games you want on PlayStation Now with over 250 titles available to stream right now. 250 titles, $100 for the whole year. What do you guys say? Is that a little more reasonable?
Yeah, I'd say so, but I think it depends on what the selection's like. Like, if they have a really big back catalog, and if they can get to the point where they can guarantee that I can play new release games.
What if I said you could play Fear?
I would say I bought it on a Steam sale for $3. Actually, Fear is one of those games where it's just like, oh, fuck, I bought a Humble Bundle, I got another copy of
another
Fear.
Another copy of Fear. What if I said you could play Lego Harry Potter years 1 through 4?
What about 5, 6, 7?
That's already in there. That's another one. I didn't want to spoil it. Also, Lego Batman, the video game.
No more Legos, man. You're fucking Legoing me.
What about Borderlands 1 and 2?
How about Lego Movie?
Again, this is... The Steam sale has really hampered my interest.
So the wind came out of their sails.
Well,
there.
Consider this. PlayStation Now actually works on the PlayStation Vita, PlayStation 4, PlayStation 3, and PlayStation Vita TV, as well as a number of televisions. So you got like cross-platform support for this. It's like your Netflix subscription. Doot-doot! I'm sorry. Let's do the hand gesture. Doot-doot. Awesome. Uncharted 4 had a trailer over at the PlayStation Experience. They also had a trailer over at the Game Awards. There was a black woman in there.
Oh.
Yeah. She was in that trailer. Only one problem.
Only one?
She's played by a white actress.
Oh, that's weird.
It sparked some controversy. What are you going to actually do about that? Neil Druckmann actually responded to this when he was being interviewed by Greg Miller. He said, someone on the team said, you have a white actor playing a black character. Are you sure you want to do that? You're inviting controversy. If you were to change these characters, we would be operating out of fear or something that's outside the game. So he went with it anyway, because he said this actress is the best actress. He said that there's also another character he doesn't want to spoil that's white in the game, but played by a black actor.
This guy sounds awesome.
Huh.
Yeah, I don't know.
I'm low voice John.
This is somewhat of a controversial subject because, you know, throughout many, many years in Hollywood, they would have white actors playing roles that were clearly not, probably not intended for white people. Like, I'm Jesus of Nazareth. Look at me, I'm white. You know?
Mm-hmm. Or in, what's the one with the robot? Johnny Five. The second one where Gutenberg's painted to look like an Arabian guy.
Yeah, there's
Speed Racer,
Short Circuit.
In Short Circuit 2, the scientist in Short Circuit 2 is played by a white guy who's trying to be an Indian guy.
Breakfast at Tiffany's, many classic films
go right for Breakfast at Tiffany's.
Amos and Andy, throughout the years, we've had some really awkward instances of white people playing characters that are supposed to be people of color.
Robert Downey Jr. in Tropic Thunder.
And now we have animation here. I mean, is this a big deal, or, you know, is this just something we have to accept when it comes to video games, that we can have people of all different types playing all different races?
Well, what I don't get is nobody cares about the voice actors until something controversial happens.
I'd be surprised, too, if this hasn't happened a lot. Like, I think the press just kind of caught on that this was happening with this game. Animation's weird, and I'd be interested to see, like, if you were to audit all the DreamWorks and Disney and Pixar movies, like, how much of this, like, kind of fluidity of like, you know, people playing different races in cartoons happens.
Shrek, not played by a green person.
But, like, the Princess and the Frog, like, I guarantee that was a black actress who played
that. Oh, my
that.
God. That would be horrible if they didn't do
what
that.
What about, like, the Cleveland show? That's a white guy doing Cleveland's voice.
That's true. That's actually a really good example. The show that was canceled after 3 seasons. So that's...
Terrible show that...
Oh, wait a minute.
Horrible.
Hold on. Doot, doot. Now we have... Beyond Two Souls, it was on the PlayStation 4. It got some graphical updates.
I thought you were going to announce the Cleveland Show video game.
One of the things that's problematic is that you actually go to the Middle East at some point in this game. And when they were doing side-by-side comparison, they noticed that for some reason all the people that are supposed to be from Saudi Arabia or wherever that takes place are white, where they used to actually have darker skin tones.
It's about colonialism.
So everyone goes, why are you whitewashing this game? Well, David Cage actually released a statement saying that
it is because of emotions.
Well, he said they completely changed the lighting engine, and when they did that, it actually, and if you go through the game, the lighting engine is improved. I didn't notice it when I did the first hour, but there's some significant differences, and he goes, it's a technical glitch. We apologize. This is not what we're trying to do. This is really just how it happened, you know.
I'm not letting him off the hook that easy.
You know.
You did that on purpose to be racist. That's what you did.
Well, he said, Quantum Dream will continue to promote racial and gender diversity in games, as well as positive human emotions and values.
Can he seriously go one interview without saying the goddamn word emotion?
Can David Cage go without one interview?
He needs emotions to live.
Doot, doot. Okay, so we know that Sony Santa Monica was teasing something. We didn't know what it was. This was actually... right before the PlayStation Experience, they revealed Linger in the Shadows, which is
Linger in the Shadows.
3D platformer that has, like, it looks like a combination between, once again, say it with me, kids, like Journey and
Prince
and
of
like,
Persia.
And like God of War. They said it's going to be very narrative focused while also having some very tight gameplay. But mostly it's about the story, and it's very abstract looking. It was pretty enticing.
Kind of stiff, though. Yeah.
I'm sorry, it's not Linger in the Shadows. The studio is Plastic, and they made Linger in the Shadows, you know. Okay. The game is called Bound.
Bound?
As in, you know.
As in that good song by Kanye?
As in the cool thing you can do with a stand-up bass? Bound. Mm-hmm. Bound. 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 Bound.
Bound. Bound. Bound. Bound. Hey, Jerry, how's it going this week at your house?
All right.
Here comes Elaine.
Jazz Punk is coming to the PlayStation 4.
Sweet.
Four player shooter multiplayer.
Ooh, I'd play it multiplayer.
There was a shooting section in Jazz Punk that I will not say out loud because I want everyone to play that fucking game. Jazz Punk is one of the best games of last year. Oh my god, I love Jazz Punk. Like, the funniest game I've ever played.
It's hilarious. It's really good.
If you ever just wanted to play something that didn't pander to you, didn't care if you got the joke, that's the game. That is the game.
Why would I want
to
play that? I'm just kidding.
Doot,
I like that game.
Metrico, the Vita game that was all about pie charts and graphs, but it was also a platformer.
Hell yeah, pie charts and graphs. Let's do this, gamers.
It's coming to the PlayStation 4 with Metrico Plus.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah, plus bar graphs now, bitch.
Yeah.
Doot, doot. Sony had a patch back in November, an update to the PlayStation 4. One of the things that was in that update, according to them, was PS4 added FMod Thread Core 6 to allow access to newly unlocked 7th Core. You might be saying, what the hell does that even mean? Well, of course, the PlayStation 4 has that AMD processor, which has 8 core, two of which are supposed to be used for system settings in general, all that kind of stuff. So it looks like they're unlocking the 7th core to allow people to have more access to it. This isn't uncommon. They did this with the PlayStation 3. Even the 360, I believe, had the exact same thing.
And this is for developers, right?
Developers. Absolutely. Although sometimes first-party games have access to this ahead of time. So that's what we know. No, we don't know for sure.
Toot, motherfucking toot.
Toot, toot. So, the Nintendo account system just opened for registration over in Japan. This is going to be that brand new account system that's replacing Nintendo Club. They also have My Nintendo that's going to give you stuff or something. Not really any news here. Just worth pointing out that, yeah, they did reveal that they're going to be going to Australia, I believe, in Europe.
Australia, then.
I'll show you.
Is shrimp on the Barbie confirmed?
We have Australian listeners. Yeah, we do. We do.
No, I know. Australian people hate when you do
Australian
that.
People love us.
Australian people love it. Click here to find out why. Australian doctors hate him. All right. Doot, doot. Shovel Knight Amiibo will be released on January 8th for $13 and will unlock the co-op mode on the Wii U version of Shovel Knight, also giving you the classic King character or some custom knights, new relics, abilities, and yada, yada, yada.
I'll take the new abilities.
Cool.
I know. And it will not be limited time, according to them, so please do not buy from scalpers. That's McRib. What they said. Don't even bother buying from scalpers. We'll have more out after the first launch. Like to see them actually saying that. Nintendo would never
scalpers,
say that.
Like behind Walmart?
Yeah. Hey, man, you looking for Shovel Knight?
I got an Amiibo right here.
I got some Amiibos in my van. Come here.
Woo! Whoa.
I don't know nothing about no Amiibos. How'd these get here? Somebody who put these Amiibos in my van?
Doot, doot. Xbox One and PC game Gigantic, which is like another...
A big
MOBA
big
type
boat.
Thing. I don't know.
I was waiting for that. Thank you.
Yeah. The game has been delayed to 2016, and they have actually lost 16 employees. That's all I can say about it.
Well, rest in peace.
Doot-doot. All right. Rise of the Tomb Raider is getting a bunch of new expansions, including Endurance Mode on December 29th, Baba Yaga, the Temple of the Witch in early 2016.
Baba Yaga.
And the Cold Darkness Awakened in 2016. They are promising multiple hours of gameplay through these modes, so look forward to that.
At least 2 hours.
Makes you wonder if the all of these will be repackaged together when it's re-released on PlayStation 4, some sort of Game of the Year edition.
You keep playing your baby games, Colin. Just keep playing your baby games.
I thought you said beta games. I'm like, I did play some beta games. All right, awesome. Doot, doot. Capcom has trademarked Onimusha. This is not a renewal. This is a new trademark for Onimusha. Holy shit.
That whole time it wasn't trademarked. I could have just gone and got a trademark.
Yeah, we could own Onimusha. Who knew?
Oh, shit. Oh, man. I'm out of coffee. All right. Doot, doot.
Two coffees.
It was leaked earlier this week that there is a brand new Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles game called Mutants in Manhattan. It will be published by Activision. Apparently it's going to be rated M for mature. And
maybe you can finally drain the lizard.
It's being developed by Platinum Games, the creators of Bayonetta 2 and Transformers Devastation, as well as Star Fox Zero.
How do you make Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles an M-rated
ooze,
game?
Ooze. Use ooze in the turtles.
I guess blood, but I mean, and then somebody's going to be like, well, you know, if you remember in the 1980s, the original comic book was very dark, and
Raphael
the cartoon made it for the kids.
Yeah, it's true.
Those are all true things.
Actually, the cartoon was launched because of the toys that were produced based off of the black and white comic book. The black and white comic book actually did continue throughout the entirety of the animated series.
Did you ever read that conspiracy article thing that Daredevil and the Turtles were created in the same accident?
Yeah, it's very interesting.
I think that's what happened.
Very interesting.
Why do they keep making this great company that made that amazing game that you love do all these really crappy licensed games?
They need money. Bayonetta 2 didn't sell. Doot, doot. This War of Yours? Nay, nay. It's This War of Mine, baby. And we've got the little ones to back it up because This War of Mine, little ones, will be released January 29th on the Xbox One, PC, and PlayStation 4.
Baby,
I'm sorry,
baby.
No PC release because it's a...
You know, it's like Snowboard Kids, but with an Eastern European conflict.
Yeah, it looks very dark and depressing, but also slightly optimistic. I don't know.
Maybe oppressing, too?
Impress.
No, did you play this War of Mine, Colin?
Unpress. Huh?
Did you play this War of Mine?
No.
It's pretty depressing. Yeah. Like, there's points where, like, your guy will just be like, you know what? I'm not going to listen to what you say. I'm super depressed and the world's going to end, so I'm not going to follow your directions.
You kill him something? It blows.
You think he's repressing? Like, seriously, I had a character who just, like, one of my other characters died and he was so upset because the guy was his friend, so he just wouldn't eat and he starved to death.
Wow, man. I'd never do that.
That sounds awesome.
Justin, when you go, I'm still going to be eating.
Yeah. You know I'm going to die before you, though, right?
Oh, you're dead.
Dude, I'm going to get up. I'm gonna get a macaroni and cheese pizza from Ian's when you die.
Yeah.
Can you get half with nothing on it?
Yeah.
Okay. For me, no, I'll be dead.
Mm-hmm. Fucking vegan.
Doot doot. Stanley Parable was a game that some people liked. I didn't. William Poog. He has revealed his brand new game,
Poog.
Dr. Lingskov and the Tiger and the Terribly Cursed Emerald, a whirlwind heist.
It's free.
Yes,
and
it's got
the guy who does the voice acting for Rick and Morty doing the voices.
Justin Roiland?
Huh?
Justin Roiland?
Sure, I think that's
the name of the creator and voice actor.
I just know it's Rick and Morty guy. But yeah, it's cool. It's free. It's on Steam.
Simon
Belmont.
Amstel. I don't know if he was.
Different guy.
I don't think he was in that, man. Rick and Morty, I don't know.
You guys see the new MST3K coming out?
This game, of course, was developed by Crows.
Oh, fuck, crows. Oh, we got more crows.
Hey, have you talked to Janice lately?
Janice, yeah, I saw Janice last night at the powwow we had out back in the street.
Oh, man, I really wanted to go over there, but I was volunteering at the no-kill shelter, so, you know, I couldn't make it out there.
Steve, you're a hipster, right? You could get in on this. We're doing a game now. It's crows.
Yeah, we're gonna call our team crows. It's
we
really
only
cool.
Listen to Decembrists.
Yeah.
We listen to fucking Decemberists?
That's
we only their independent stuff.
I'm Colin Malloy. I wrote a bunch of albums about World War II and
no,
love.
We listen to the
I now have a
stuff
children's book you may like.
When it was the woman that wrote all the songs, it's just a lot better, you know?
When he freed the woman. Back when he let the woman be free.
Hey, did you hear Crows is opening for Arcade Fire? It's going to be super good.
Wow. Are we going to show our new footage or?
Crows featuring members of Chick Chick Chick.
Yeah, it's going to be great.
It's all exclamation points.
Yeah. Hand me that PBR. Okay. Doot doot. Super Smash Bros. Brawl. Controversial game. Fanbase didn't really care for it. Luckily, there was a mod for it that was known as...
Mods?
Project M. It's been around for many years. Many people really like it. It had some gameplay improvements. I believe it added some stages. I don't know if it added any characters or not. But they are shutting it down in terms of project. Nintendo didn't shut it down. They're just like, we're done with this. We're going to build a new project from the ground up.
So, a new Smash Brothers?
Something. All right, guys. Let's close out the hype train by talking about the games that are going to be out this week. On Tuesday, Earth Defense 2, Invaders from Planet Space will be out on the Vita.
Cool title.
As well as Earth Defense Force 4.1, The Shadow of Despair on the PlayStation 4. Yakuza 5 will be out on the PlayStation 3. Lots of PlayStation on Tuesday. On Wednesday, Baseball Riot is going to be released on the PlayStation 4, Xbox One, Vita, iPhone, Android, PC.
Baseball Riot.
On Thursday, Lightning Returns, Final Fantasy 13 will be released on the PC. Roller Coaster Tycoon World is going to be released on the PC. Steam World Heist. It's going to be released on the new 3DS.
Related to SteamWorld Dig?
Oh, yeah.
Can I play this on my regular 3DS or just the new one?
I hope it's just the new 3DS.
I hope not.
Terraria is coming to the 3DS.
That's cool. That's a good 3DS
game.
I have it on my tablet.
It's on Vita.
Fast Racing Neo is going to be on the Wii U, which is this F-Zero spiritual successor. It looks amazing. It really does. And on Friday, Devil's Third.
I almost, like, I don't have any money, but I almost want to buy it just because everything I read about it, it just sounds like this beautiful shit show.
I cannot wait. And that's going to do it for the chart part, guys. Let's jump out the train. Oh, my God. That's going to do it for the hype train. Stay tuned after this. No funny commercial. Go to iTunes. Give us 5 stars. Written review. We really need it. We are so close to having perfect 5 stars on iTunes right now. For the love of God, just go to iTunes right now. Go to the Pressure Cast. Write a review. Say it's the best thing ever. Say it's the worst thing ever. I don't mind. Say whatever you want. But please give us 5 stars. We're so close to having 5 stars again. We already had some people that actually did give us 5 stars recently, including Greg. Thank you. I read that review.
Thank you, Greg.
Very, 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 very kind. We want this show to get bigger. We want more people to listen to it. So share it with your friends. That'd be great. Okay. That's it.
My podcast already has 5 stars.
Yeah, shut up.
My podcast doesn't have it yet.
My dog has fleas. Okay, good. I got the acronym. iTunes, 5 stars, written review. Thank you. Welcome back to the show, everybody. Welcome back to the show.
Back in time.
Let's get into it, guys. The games of the week. We really need to cook through this. Okay, I played Just Cause 3 on the PlayStation 4. The load times are really horrendous. The frame rate is not steady. It is not a good game because of that. I cannot play that game. I do not recommend that game. If you're going to play it on PC. Do not even bother playing it on the PlayStation 4.
Don't play it on PC yet. It's still really buggy.
Don't play it anywhere then. It's just more Just Cause. You also have a wingsuit. It seems okay. I wasn't really into the gameplay. And the cutscenes are absolutely horrible. Beyond that, whatever. Okay, I played Rainbow Six Siege on the PlayStation 4. This is a multiplayer shooter that plays a lot like Counter-Strike. It's not really a Rainbow Six game. The basic gameplay is that you have a team that's trying to infiltrate, and you have a team that's trying to defend. They might be defending a bomb. They might be defending a hostage. So when it starts off, you have 30 seconds, if you're on the offense, to actually send in these little RC cars with cameras on them to examine the area, find the objective, find where people are, and, you know, map out your route and how you're going to go in there while the other guys are building barricades. You just walk up, build barricades, and that's all pretty cool. You actually have special classes like a sledgehammer guy that can break through barricades with a sledgehammer, or people that can build very special barricades, or people that can blow up random walls. There's a lot of destruction in this game. You can actually punch holes through walls and then shoot people. Everybody goes down after just a couple of shots.
Cool.
Lots of different types of guns on there. It's very tense. It's very fun. Unfortunately, that's really all you can do in that game, and that's a lot to ask for. For asking for that much time out of you to level up just to play more of the exact same game mode. Doesn't have a whole lot of depth. Single player, not really all that great. It's just teaching you the basics on how to play the game, but it does introduce you to all the different classes. Every time you unlock a different class, because there's at least 18 different ones, offense and defense, they actually have a little cutscene that shows their power-ups. It kind of reminds me of Twisted Metal in a weird way. Hmm. Like how they used to start with Twisted Metal by showing how cool the character was. So, you know, like the guy that can build special barricades that are bulletproof, he's just sitting there reloading his gun slowly while bullets are just flying through this shack and all this light's pouring in. But he's just standing behind his barricade and he's just like, amateurs. Pretty cool stuff. You know, it's okay, but there's just not a whole lot of depth there. But, you know, if you got a couple of friends and you really want to, you know, play something for a little bit. I don't imagine that the online play is going to last very long.
Is there a campaign mode? Like a robust campaign?
There's also terrorist hunt mode. The single player, for some reason, that single player training mode is in 30 frames per second. It doesn't make any sense why that's 30 frames. The multiplayer, 60 frames. Whatever. Who cares? There's also terrorist hunt mode, which involves a lot of yellow gas, which makes it very difficult to actually see where you're going. But I guess it's supposed to raise the tension. I found it all rather boring. I did have the best moment ever, though, where I was on the defense. I tore down one of my barricades because I wanted to build it up with a more special barricade. And as soon as I tore it down, there was just somebody standing there. I was like, what the fuck? I just shot him to death and then built the barricade back up. I have a video. I'll put it up online. It's stupid and fun. So no, don't bother with that one. It can be fun at times, but I can't imagine this is going to have, you know, very long legs there.
You sound kind of blasé about it.
Nah. I did play Xenoblade Chronicles X on the Wii U. This, of course, is the sequel to Xenoblade Chronicles that was on the Wii, Steve's favorite game. This is a game that I think if you're into anime, you'll like it quite a bit. It's kind of self-serious, kind of weird. Someone actually asked me, I think it was Greg actually asked me on YouTube. He's like, I've never played JRPG. What the heck is this? Should I get into this? And I was like, yeah, this is the perfect place to start because so many other JRPGs are really kind of shoddy and cheap these days. Just two 2D characters talking back and forth with kind of repetitive dialogue.
Disgaea style?
No, you know, yeah, I mean, yeah, now it is, but yeah. It's like bad Disgaea. They're, you know,
at least Disgaea is kind of funny and has, you know, poignant, sharp writing.
Stupid voice acting.
This game is, it ranges from very serious because the intro starts off with the earth exploding because it got caught in the middle.
Earth shattering?
Yeah, earth shattering, literally. It got stuck in the middle of an alien war. And while that war was happening, the earth was exploded. And so they escaped on this ship. All the other ships got destroyed. This one ship is landed on this planet. And it is a gigantic world where you can explore these giant creatures. Seriously, giant fucking creatures in this game. I'm talking like...
Freaking me out.
Dinosaurs. Humongous, like, brontosauruses. Except they got, like, giant eyeballs at the end. It's really, it's creepy and spooky, but it's cool meeting all these different creatures.
Creepy and spooky.
The art design is amazing. The performance on the game is generally good. The only issue really is that there's a lot of pop-in in some areas. I'm talking you'll walk up to an area in New L.A.
New L.A., that's right.
That's where you live on this alien planet. It's supposed to be modeled after Los Angeles. You walk up to this building, and it's just there's no texture whatsoever. It's just a gray box, and it just pops in. It's really distracting.
That sounds like L.A. to me.
If you're going to play this game, I highly recommend that you actually fix your camera, because the camera does this auto
swoosh. Your camera's broken.
It does this
fix it, man.
No, seriously, it's fucking awful. It's first of all, it's slow, and second of all, it does this autocorrect thing where it slowly tilts after you let go of the camera button. It just does that slow tilt. It's like, no, I want it to be right there. I don't need you to move it there, so you can actually fix that. Turn that off. The basic combat is just kind of like a MMO. You just go into attack mode. They're automatically attacking at the bottom of your screen. You have these things called arts where you actually select them. They have like a timer on them and how often you can use them.
It's like an ability hotbar in like World of Warcraft or something with cooldowns.
But they actually become more powerful the more you let them charge, but they're dependent on what weapon you're holding because everyone has two weapons. So if one of them is based around like a sword, then you have to have the sword in your hand to build it up to be extra powerful, which means that the gun ones will still build up, but they won't get that bonus build. They'll, you know, it's the difference between doing an attack with 100 or 350 points, so you really do want to pay attention to what you're doing there. All in all, I think it's pretty damn interesting. I'm only about 5 hours in, so I really can't say much. This game is going to be huge. I think
the biggest game of all time, right?
I think if you're into JRPGs, you really need to get out there and buy yourself a Wii U. But if you don't really care about classic JRPGs, then you really shouldn't worry about it, Justin.
Somebody was telling me that it's bigger than like Fallout 4 and combined with like all these other giant games. Like it's just as big as the three biggest games combined.
It's humongous and there's five continents. It's absolutely magnificent.
I don't need this.
I know.
But I want it.
Yeah, I know. And lastly, I did play the Uncharted 4 multiplayer beta. That beta is actually pretty damn good. It's only team deathmatch. They've adjusted the multiplayer on Uncharted. Uncharted 3 has one of my favorite multiplayer modes of all time. Blew me away. This is the most vertical of vertical slices. The thinnest vertical slice imaginable. You only get two different stages, one in a jungle and one in a city, like a small, like, I don't know, Middle Eastern town. You can pick from heroes or villains or whatever. What's interesting is that you they have this cash system for every kill that you get. They have different. Well, hold on, let me start over. I'm talking really fast.
Cast system?
There's the down system and the KO system. Down system is when you put someone on the ground, they'll be crawling on the ground, but they can still be revived. That's worth $100. Then there's KO. When you kill them, you get $50. Every action you perform gets you money. That money means you can purchase items while you're in the multiplayer match. You're like, oh man, I want to get an RPG, so you can buy an RPG to blow up people right on the fly. You also get these things that are called relics. They're basically your kill streak rewards, except you can activate them whenever you have enough money for it. So like one of them is, it's a totem that just shoots out evil spirits that attack nearby players. Another one's kind of like your UAV, and it shows you where everyone is on the map. These are all really cool systems. Also sidekicks. You can actually create these AI characters that follow you, like snipers and people with miniguns, and they'll help you out while you're fighting. So because a lot of the Uncharted multiplayer is based around teamwork, so you can actually create your own teammates. So I always like to take my sniper and put them up somewhere high, and then I run down and start fighting people. So my sniper's picking off people while we're playing. It's really cool. It's absolutely a blast. I had a lot of fun with it, but it's a very, very, very thin vertical slice.
Early beta.
It's only going for the next 10 days, so if you have a copy of Uncharted Nathan Drake Collection, definitely download it. It's a good time. I had fun. Any questions? I'm sorry.
Any questions?
I'm talking really fast.
So out of all these games, what's the one that I should play this week?
Xenoblade Chronicles X.
Good, because that's the one I bought. So
the Xenoblade Chronicles X is a very interesting game. It's a little slow, and I don't think they explain the mechanics quite right, especially because while they do encourage you to use the classic controller, as I would, because playing anything on the gamepad sucks, except for like Splatoon, you still need the touchscreen because you have these probes that you need to put into the ground and you need to activate them and change their purpose, and you have to do that on the touchscreen. All of fast travel is done on the touchscreen, but they don't tell you that. You could literally turn off the touchscreen and play with your classic controller, or I'm sorry, pro controller, which I highly recommend.
Great, something else that I need to buy, a Wii U.
Seriously, go buy a Wii U.
Somebody just
buy me a Wii U.
I wasn't going to say it.
But you were thinking it.
Well, I don't want to buy it. That's why.
Whatever. You could get.
I got two kidneys. Sell one of those.
You could get Splatoon and Super Smash Brothers for, I think, what is it? It's $349, but whatever, you can get for cheaper if you look around.
I didn't know that we did ads during the show.
Motherfucker. All right, it's getting a little heated in here, so why don't we go outside?
Wait, we didn't
guys.
Do our games of the week.
What do you got? What do you got?
Metal Gear Solid 5, it's good.
Was it the games of three fucking months ago?
Well, I did Bloodborne a couple weeks ago, and you were like, what is the games of last year? And then, all right, never mind.
Fantastic, guys. Let's hurry up. Let's go over to one of the places we like to go, where it's always warm with the glow of money.
Finally
outside,
warm.
We are going to
The Chart Park, the land where money grows on trees. Yes, the Chart Park. This is the part of the show where we find out which fat cats of Wall Street will tip their top heads towards Lady Luck as we talk all the business, financial, and legal news in the video game industry with Art. This is, bar none, the biggest business news of the week. Tatsumi.
Drum roll, please.
Tatsumi Kimishima, the president of Nintendo, who took over Iwata's post after Iwata passed away, had an interview with Time Magazine and had a lot to say about the NX. He had this to say about the Wii U. As you know, within the game business, momentum is key. When you have momentum, whether it's a platform or software, sales increase. At this point in the Wii U lifespan, we're looking at 10 million sell-through for the hardware itself, which is just about a tenth of what we sold overall for the Wii. So he's not in denial at all of what's going on here. He's very well aware that the Wii U has not sold very good, as everyone else is. What he said is, first job right now is to make sure that the customers, those 10 million customers who have a Wii U at home, have software to play, and we need to make sure that they are satisfied with their purchase and continue to enjoy playing on this platform. So we can just abandon them and say, So we can't just abandon them and say, hey, it's time to move on to the next thing. So it looks like the Wii U is still going to have games, regardless of the fact that the NX is coming out. But the question is, are we going to get real games, or are we going to get more Amiibo festivals and Mario Tennis?
Probably a little bit of column A and a little bit of column B. Makes sense, I'd say. Also, I think we're going to see a lot of crossover games. We talked about this with the new Legend of Zelda.
Yeah, absolutely.
So it could be a Twilight Princess situation. I would be surprised if Star Fox ended up in the same way.
That's interesting. He also had something to say about the NX. This is rather interesting. I can assure you we're not building the next version of the Wii or Wii U. It's something unique and different. It's something where we have to move away from those platforms in order to make something that will appeal to our customer base. What is that?
New controller. Okay. It's a new controller.
Here's what I want. I want a packed-in Pro controller. What's it called now? Oh, yeah, it's called the Pro controller, right?
Yeah, whatever.
Yeah. Which, I love that controller. Also, the battery life is like 90 years.
Majeure.
Yeah, which, you know, the PS4, it's like every 2 hours I'm plugging the damn thing in. I want a system with that packed in, and I also want it to be like hybrid home console portable, and I want my Nintendo Netflix thing that I've been begging them for. Then I'll have everything. Me and Big Reg, we got to sit down and hash this thing out.
I think they're looking at the success of the PlayStation 4 and even the Xbox One to some degree and going, well, that's just a console with a controller and games. And maybe we need to just no more motion.
Stop with the dumb shit.
No more motion controllers, no more game pads, no more anything. Although that really does limit them in terms of backwards compatibility, you know?
I wouldn't be surprised, though, if maybe, you know, they keep... You mentioned a few weeks ago how they were starting to sell the actual tablet controller in Japan.
Exactly.
So maybe they keep compatibility for the Wii remote. They keep compatibility for the gamepad from the Wii U for both backwards compatibility and if, you know, if devs want to use that stuff, that's cool.
The PlayStation 3 actually could have PlayStation memory cards if you had the accessory. I mean, PlayStation 2 memory cards and PS1 memory cards, you know, if you had the accessory. So keeping those as bonuses that are not implemented in any way towards any of the NX releases would be very smart. Maybe with something with, like, I don't know, Mario Maker 2 when it comes with a gamepad or something like that, like gamepad 2.
Yeah, but I think because Mario Maker is probably the best proof of concept thing I've seen on the Wii U. Like, it really, like that, and there's a game that came out, it's actually an indie game, called Affordable Space. That is a great use of the gamepad. So
I would say it's better than Mario Maker in terms of use.
Wait,
sure.
What do you do with it?
You basically run all the systems on your ship, so instead of controlling it directly, like, you adjust thrust and things like that from the gamepad.
Imagine the 2D flight simulation version of Steel Battalion. And that's basically what it is. Like, you're turning on flashlights, you're turning on everything.
Oh, it's great with multiplayer, too, because you can have, like, up to, I think, 3 or 4 people, and, like, everybody does a different part of the ship, so it's got, like, almost like an Octodad in, like, the Star Trek universe going on.
So, back to the interview, he also had this... No.
That was awesome.
No, that game is very much worth mentioning. He also mentioned Amiibo, saying, we're seeing instead is that Amiibo are being picked up more as collector items at this point rather than, say, an interactive item with software, and so we haven't really established them as an enhancement for all of our overall software at this point. I think, again, that is the challenge. How can we connect that IP to our software in general, and using Amiibo to further enhance the play activity, which is amazing. He's admitting, like, yeah, what, no one's using this for games. This is just a toy for a lot of people. And honestly, what's the best example of Amiibo? What, the Smash Brothers, where you train something? Tennis, where you train something?
The Shovel Knight one.
I mean, that unlocks more game modes, but even then, it's like, I still don't understand why I have this. You know, I mean,
why are they so popular then, though?
Because people love little collectible Nintendo things. Like, if you think of them as like, oh, what if Nintendo made a line of collectible small action figures? Like, that's kind of where
it's obvious what they need to do.
Mm-hmm. You got your Mario action figures.
No, you got your NES Amiibo. You put them on there. You get a free copy of Earthbound.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if you tie digital games to them, it'd be nice.
What, you got that 8-bit Mario? Well, here's a free copy of Super Mario All-Stars, because that's a more rare one. Like, give people games.
Give people what they want.
They want games. Yep. Don't give them these weird modes that are just like, well, they can't be too essential, because then otherwise we're screwing over the people that buy the base game and don't want Amiibos. No, give us actual virtual console games that you can either buy on the virtual console or you can have the Amiibo, and if it's the exact same price, it's like, psh, well, I'll get the Amiibo, you know?
Blue finger mode.
So, we've also had this report that said that they were going to ship 20 million. Remember that DigiTimes reported that? Mm-hmm. They've scaled that back and said they're going to be shipping 12 million NXs next year. This is going to be made over at Foxconn. This is just a report. There's no confirmation about this. 12 million NXs next year. That's what they're saying.
What's Forbes magazine said this? Wall Street Journal, maybe?
DigiTimes.
DigiTimes, okay.
Digital Times.
DigiTimes are the
champions.
Best newspaper.
They haven't even sold 12 million Wii U's.
And they're going to ship 12 million? What, are they going to be like a dollar each or something?
Well, and that's why this seems like it's going to be more of a traditional console. And keep in mind, this is, when we talk about shipping, it's not like they necessarily plan on selling these all immediately. Like, this is just, I mean, this is what they're manufacturing right now.
Absolutely.
And 20 is a bit, that's a bit much. But
well, do we even know that this is even going to be a console? Like, they doubled down. They said they were going to double down on consoles. Mario Wada, when they announced their partnership with DNA, said, we're still interested in home consoles, and they announced the NX. But what if this is something, you know,
portable console?
What if it's a phone? What if it's,
phone, Jesus. I would not trust Nintendo with a cell phone. Maybe if it was like a rotary phone, I'd let them do that.
Put the phone down, Nintendo.
Stop using the phone.
It's connected to a bomb.
It's got a recharge.
Excellent.
Before the bomb can go up.
I don't know. We'll have to wait and see. Then we'll start talking about the NX.
There's got to be something portable about it.
I mean, that's what everyone keeps saying. And
like,
that's
super lightweight. You just move it around.
Well, I think a lot of that stems from the fact that it's like, this must have been like a year ago now, but when those like patents or whatever leaked, or Nintendo filed for a patent.
Yeah.
So I think that it comes from that.
Hey, I'm still waiting on my PlayStation 3 controller that breaks in half and turns into Move controllers.
Mm.
Patents, baby. There's just a picture of a man staring at a television where a man played soccer. That is the best patent art I've ever seen. DNA. Bad news for DNA. They have, of course, a studio in Singapore, which apparently is going to be shut down and integrated into other studios. This also resulted in a number of their employees being laid off. There were only 50 employees there. Of course, DNA now has a partnership with Nintendo, so always important to focus on what they're up to. Also, more layoffs, this time over in Israel, which the studio over in Israel from Microsoft was working on HoloLens, 60 jobs slashed, which is rather significant.
R.I.P.
Well, it's that time of year, too. Like, all the layoffs happen before the end of the fiscal year, so you always see, like, December into January, like, Christmas time is layoff time in video game land.
Time to go home for the holidays.
Long story short, they said, hey, investments, continued support, investments, employees, value, investments. That's basically what they said. Sega, oh boy. Okay.
Sega po' boys, that sounds like a good sandwich.
Sega is predicting their end of the year, you know, end of fiscal year, financial forecasting right now. Those are words. Put them together. There you go. They had the expected revenue of $2.8 billion.
Wow.
Now, you might say, why does this matter? Because their previous forecast was $3.4 billion. So that is down by $0.6 billion, $600 million.
Mm-hmm.
That's revenue. I want you to prepare yourself for this. They had their profit forecasted at $154.3 million. Listeners, $154.3 million. They've revised that to $16.2 million.
That's not a lot of money.
That's almost 90% readjustment
for prop. A bake sale next, you think? They're going to do a little fundraiser?
Speak up in the mic, you little...
Are they going to do a big bake sale?
Yeah. You know, nothing saves your company like lemon bars, am I right?
They had to release a statement on here. How in the hell can you revise your profit by 90%? Here's what they had to say. They are actually moving their focus to higher quality content is expected, thus resulting in a trend of longer development lead times. So they're going to take their time. They're not just going to push things out the door. So
I love that, though. They're like, we're going to make better games. That's our answer.
That should
be the answer to every game developer's problems, huh?
Well, best of luck to THQ. I'm sorry, Sega.
I want the THQ news press conference where, we're just going to make better games now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right, guys, let's close it out with the chart park. We have the charts. Here are the 10 best-selling games in the UK. Number 10 is Forza Motorsport 6. Number 9 is Rise of the Tomb Raider. Number 8 is Halo Guardians. Those three, all Xbox exclusives, worth noting. Hmm. Number 7 is Minecraft Story Mode. Number 6 is Grand Theft Auto 5. Number 5 is Uncharted the Nathan Drake Collection. Number 4 is Fallout 4. Number 3 is Star Wars Battlefront. Number 2 is Call of Duty Black Ops 3. And number 1 is FIFA 16.
FIFA?
Whole new way to play footy.
It's like real life.
Let's go over to Godzillaville to find out what are the 10 best-selling games in Japan. Number 10, still hanging on, is Call of Duty Black Ops 3. Number 9 is TV anime The Idolmaster Cinderella Girls G4U Pack Volume 6.
Cannot wait for that classic. To come stateside, yeah.
Number 8 is Criminal Girls 2.
Oh, come on.
Number 7 is... Let's whisper it this time. Let's do it different. Yo-Kai Watch Busters, Red Cat Team, White Dog Squad.
I screwed up.
You might have, maybe. Number 6 is Hyperdimension Neptunia versus Sega Hard Girls Dream Fusion Special.
Did you say Tony Hawk versus Sega?
Yeah, why not? Number 5 is Star Wars Battlefront. Number 4 is Super Mario Maker. Number 3, still, Splatoon. Holy crap. Number 2 is Akatsu, my number 1 stage. And number 1.
Classic.
Predictably, Monster Hunter X, which is brand new for that week, selling
a bajillion.
Should we get that game?
1.4 million copies in a week?
That's a lot for Japan. Jesus.
That is a lot for Japan. Now let's look at the best-selling consoles. Kicking off with the new 3DS LL with 105,629. That's really good. That's up over nearly 80,000. That's how well this Monster Hunter game is selling. Think about that. Followed by PlayStation 4 with 26,598, Wii U with 20,256, New 3DS with 18,052, PlayStation Vita with 14,765, 3DS with 6,095, PlayStation 3 with 1,643, 3DS LL with 12,047. Wow, that's over double for even the 3DS LL. Mm-hmm. PlayStation Vita TV with 625. And in last place, thank God, order is restored, is the Xbox One with 591. That's going to do it for the chart park.
The land where money grows on trees.
Let's get tiny. It's time for Pocket Talk.
I'm just a little guy.
Okay, fantastic. Yo-Kai Watch has overall shipped 10 million. That is up 7 million since March, ensuring that Yo-Kai Watch is doing okay.
Okay, Watch. Okay, Watch.
I don't think you should be writing headlines, buddy.
Also worth noting, Yo-Kai Watch Just Dance will be out shortly in Japan.
Are you fucking serious?
I'm dead serious.
It's like Persona 4.
I
want to
dance. Oh my God, with the red
you can
cat.
Dance if you wanna,
in the white dog squad. Do the white dog shuffle.
Dude, I've flipped on that. Red dog all the way. White dog, cool. But no, that red cat, he is wonderful. He is wonderful. He's brave. But and that world is against him. Anyway, Rayman Adventures launched on iOS and Android this week. You got 150 stages. Just worth noting. Go download. It's free to play.
Is it another Endless Runner?
No. I mean, yes and no. It's 150 stages, so it's segmented. Mm. So, you know.
Stages, Steve. It's stages.
And lastly, Bandai Namco has trademarked Tap My Katamari.
Ooh.
So maybe we'll have
Tap That Katamari.
Maybe Katamari Damacy.
Tap that.
Will be coming to a phone near you or handheld system. And that's going to do it for Pocket Talk, everybody. Let's take the mushroom, Justin.
Bloop, 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 bloop.
This guy.
It's a blooper again.
Oh, and by the way, the idiot of the week is still Konami. What the fuck is wrong with you, you stupid company?
It's not me.
Fuck Konami.
Okay, before we close out the show, let's take a look at the week that was in strong history.
Going back in time.
10 years ago, this week... Yakuza, the original, was released on the PlayStation 2 in Japan, becoming one of the most popular Sega franchises of the 21st century. 11 years ago, The Lord of the Rings, Battle for Middle-earth, which was actually probably the most popular RTS on the consoles there.
Damn.
Star Wars Knights of the Republic 2 The Sith Lords was released on the Xbox. I didn't like that one as much.
That one was okay. Yeah. I liked it. Okay. Whatever.
Whatever. And the PSP was released in Japan.
Ooh.
The rest is history.
Does nothing impress you, motherfuckers? 15 years ago. 15 years ago, Grandia 2 was released on Dreamcast.
Oh, I love the crap out of that game. One of my favorites. You would.
There we go.
That's pretty amazing. Good. That's a really good game.
Amazing.
Project Justice, the sequel to Rival Schools, was released in Japan.
We never got that one here.
Yeah, you can synchronize swim as an attack.
I would have loved to.
It's really good. Mm. It's really, really good. American McGee's Alice was released on the PC. Pretty memorable game.
It is.
And the WonderSwan Color was launched 18 months after its original.
Fuck.
15 years ago this week. 16 years ago this week, Nintendo 64 DD, the add-on to the Nintendo 64 Japan only, that included a Mario Paint game, which is kind of cool.
There's like four Mario Art games, and then that
Doshin the Giant.
Yeah, Doshin the Giant. Shout out to Doshin.
What up, Doshin?
He's just waving.
Hashtag bring back Doshin.
Bring back the yellow guy. Oof. 17 years ago on the Nintendo 64, Salt Park was released, and I was very happy about it, and I was wrong.
Is it that racer?
No,
it's the first-person shooter.
Where they actually copied Perfect Dark, so you could have two versions of the same weapon. So like you'd have a snowball, and if you put in the second mode, you would pee on the snowball.
Mm-hmm. It's good if you like fog and endlessly respawning enemies.
Speaking of fog, also 17 years ago, Turok 2 Seeds of Evil.
Fuck yeah, Fog of Evil.
Mm-hmm. 18 years ago on the Saturn, Shining Force 3 was released in Japan, never came to the United States. But
oh, that's sad.
I know.
I bet that game rules.
Yeah, school drools.
But the game rules.
Game rules. 20 years ago on the SNES, Breath of Fire 2.
I just beat that again recently, actually. But I got the secret character this time. There's one secret character that you unlock her, and it just makes the game so easy. She's like really crazy overpowered. She's the wizard from the first game. What's it, a wizardress if it's a female wizard? Let's keep going.
Okay.
A big question on everyone's mind.
22 years ago, Eternal Champions was released on the Genesis.
Yeesh.
Yeesh.
I like that game.
Have you played it recently?
Yeah,
have you played
it's not
it recently,
great,
Kyle?
But I like that game. I like to play as the guy with the trident.
It's got Moxie.
I know. I like to play. There's a wizard there, and the wizard can change your controls. It's a fighting game.
It's a wizardress.
Also, 22 years ago, some game called Doom was
Never
released on the PC.
It. You got that on shareware, bro?
I think so. Okay, I'm going to call up Apogee and get the rest of them.
Ask Vin Diesel.
23 years ago, over in Japan, Final Fantasy V was released, which we would not get in America for some years.
I've got it.
Yeah, I do. 24 years ago, Mega Man 4 was released in Japan. 25 years ago, Little Nemo the Dream Master was released in Japan on the Famicom.
Love that
underrated game.
My God. I don't think it's underrated. I think it's just underknown. If you play it right away, you're like, oh, yeah, this is brilliant.
It's incredibly hard, but I beat it, guys. You don't have to worry.
That train stage, bro.
Train stage? Stages towards the end are pretty hard, but you get that sweet scepter where you can shoot lasers.
Dude, I just want that B-suit. That's all I need.
B-suit sweet?
That's all I need.
Music's great, too.
Mm-hmm. 27 years ago, Ninja Gaiden was released on the Famicom in Japan. And lastly, 30 years ago in Japan, 1942 was released on the NES.
All right.
Why does that matter?
You put it in the show. That's why it matters.
Why does that matter?
It's
because 1942 was actually not developed in-house by Capcom. It was some other port house, some crappy port house. Why does this matter? Because that is the very first Capcom game to be released on the NES. The sales were good. They went, okay, let's create something original, resulting in Mega Man and everything you know about Capcom. Mm. No longer arcade, very console-centric.
Also, shout out to 1942 for having some of the worst video game music I've ever heard in my entire life. And then just the sound of someone crumpling paper. Like, I don't even know what it is. Like, someone sat on the keyboard and they accidentally shipped it with the game. Like, it's fucking awful. But I love that game, so there.
30 years ago this week. Awful. Steve! Justin! Galen, where Galen. Can people reach you on the internet?
Hey, you can find me on the World Wide Web on Twitter.com, at Steve Cuff. That's at Steve C-U-F-F. That's at Steve
C-U-Friendly-Face.
Also, you go to OptimismVaccine.com. You can go to YouTube.com/OptimismVaccine. You can go to iTunes. You can listen to the OpVac cast, which is the podcast that I host, and we talk about music and movies and TV and pop culture and weird shit, and it's fucking great. Also, if you go to Optimus Vaccine this week, I just wrote an article, and it's the 5 best albums that you did not listen to.
Talking to you,
false.
Did not listen to any of these albums.
Like them.
Yeah, they're really fucking good. So if you're like, oh man, I want to listen to some cool music, and I'm sick of seeing every single list with Kendrick Lamar's album as number one, which is pretty good, but you know. Yeah. Listen to some other stuff, too.
Listen to some Crows, Crows, Crows.
Crows, Crows, Crows.
That's what's all about.
Their early stuff, though.
Bros, Bros, Bros.
So, great. Go to iTunes. Give OpVacCast 5 stars. Check it out. OptimismVaccine.com.
Hey, if you guys are looking for me online, look on YouTube and find me and Colin on there as Justin and Colin are the game players. Our most recent episode is a review of Skittles, and it's my best work to date.
Luke on YouTube, you got it.
I'd say it's definitely your best work, but I'd call it lesser Colin.
It's definitely B-side Colin. Mm-hmm.
B-side. Well, sometimes B-sides are the best sides.
Well, besides that, where can people reach you on Twitter?
At Justin Engelbart. I don't use it, though, so don't even bother. But Sparky Finkster on PSN. You can look me up on there.
Hey, hit him up on MySpace.
Fantastic. You can always go to youtube.com/videogamesaredumb. If you want to see a video on Yakuza 5, I'll be doing a first hour on that, as well as both of the Earth Defense Force games that will be released on Tuesday. Of course, go to iTunes or Stitcher. Go to iTunes. What am I saying Stitcher for? Give the Pressure Cast 5 stars and a written review. That'd be fantastic. You can follow me on Twitter at Dr. Crychop. That's at Dr. Crychop. Or you can even follow the Pressure Cast at Pressure Cast Pod. Remember, you can call us 954-947-7377. Email us pressurecast@gmail.com. And like I said, tweet us at Pressure Cast Pod. Guys, it's been a long episode.
Sad time on the show.
But it's time to close it out. Because it's over. But fear not, listener, because the Pressure Cast is forever. Pressure Cast, weekly video game news podcast, is solely owned and operated by Colin Tanner. Guests of the Pressure Cast are not employees or freelancers of Colin Tanner, the Pressure Cast, or VideoGamesAreDumb.com, and are not paid. Music featured on the Pressure Cast is property of their respective owners, and no infringement is intended. For more information, email pressurecast@gmail.com.
Yeah, I mean, like, I know you want to catch some shit, but, like, you ever think about how, like, the brain named itself?
Yeah, that name came out of nowhere, man. It came
like,
from the brain.
Like, a brain just thought, like, I'm going to call myself a brain.
Why is it so good?
Because fucking stoners are idiots.
There we go. You ready, guys? All right, let's do it.
This week on Pokemon.
Yeah, I'll do a narration thing.
Pokemon!
On today's adventure of Pokemon, Bash Batchum is on the search for a Birdle.
Wow, where am I? This is the same trail?
Pika, Pika.
What's that, Pika?
Pika, 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 Pika.
iTunes?
Pika.
Did somebody say iTunes?
Pika, Pika.
Hey, don't be giving us those stupid negative reviews anymore, Team Bucket.
Oh, that we got to start over. That's too hard of a B.
You gotta give me an oh no, it's Team Bucket because I show up to fuck your shit up.
Yeah, and you gotta do
They're
your.
Here to fuck my shit up again.
You can say that.
Okay, good.
And you gotta say Bessie and Bames.
Oh, yeah. Bessie and Bames. Okay.
Team Bucket are here.
And then I'll do the Team Rocket intro.
Yeah. Do you actually know that?
Yes.
We'll figure it out.
I'll do an abridged version because it's actually really long.
It is. On today's episode of Pokemon, Bash Batchum is out in the forest trying to find a Birdle.
It kind of just looks like a turtle, but it's blue. I don't know.
Blita, blita.
Pika, what's that?
Blita, blita, blita.
Oh, no. It's Team Bucket. They're here to fuck our shit up.
That's right.
Start over.
I started laughing at what I was going to say.
I couldn't help myself either. Fuck me.
I'm Pikachu. I'm not Bika.
Well, he calls him Pika, doesn't he?
No, it, no, it no. doesn't. Never calls him Beaker.
All
right. You're really mad about that.
You should include that.
On today's episode of Pokemon, Bash Batchum and Pikachu are out in the forest trying to find a birdle.
Wow, so what's it looks like a turtle, but it's blue, right? That's how I'm going to catch this thing?
Pika, Pika, Pikachu.
What's that, Pikachu?
Pika, 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 Pika.
Oh, no, it's Team Bucket. They're here to fuck our shit up.
That's right.
I can't even do it.
We got it.
I can't say that's right. I'm just going to start like,
that's right.
That's funny. That's good. It's good. Here we go.
Okay.
On today's episode of Pokemon, Bash Batchum and Pikachu are out in the forest trying to find a birdle.
Come on, Pikachu. We're looking for this blue-looking turtle kind of thing, I think it looks like.
Pika, Pika, Pikachu.
What's that, Pikachu?
Pika, 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 Pika.
Oh, no. There's Team Bucket again. They're probably here to fuck our shit up.
Prepare for trouble. Make it double. Oh. Jesse! James! Oh, fuck. I fucked up their names.
Oh, you meant Bessie and Babes are here.
Bessie and Babes.
All right,
that's actually how it goes.
Okay.
Right. I fucked up their names. I'm
dude,
sorry.
You gotta
I keep
say
it.
That's right.
Dude, I keep October 2016ing this.
He's just cooking these chicken tenders on this little grill in the backyard. It's so funny to me. And the other guy gets mad at him for using his grill, and he shakes him up. It's just so stupid. It's so funny.
Maybe I got some sweet puss.
Yeah, well, I bet you got this.
Yeah, Jesus Christ.
See?